The Freaky Friday train stops tonight in Chattanooga, Tennessee for the 1AA National Football Championship. Featuring two schools rolling into new territory. Northern Iowa makes its first ever title game appearance. And Appalachian State is also making its championship debut. Anything can happen for first timers on Freaky Friday, and this one's for a championship. Outside of sold-out Finley Stadium on a chilly night in Chattanooga as two first-time finalists in the 1AA National Championship game look to freeze a moment in time. The biggest game in school history for both Appalachian State and Northern Iowa. The Mountaineers from Boone, North Carolina won the Southern Conference and are the number two seed in the 16-team playoff. Appalachian State played all three of its postseason games at home, beating Lafayette, Southern Illinois, and then last week, Furman. And the Mountaineers led this game 14-0 after one Trey Elder a touchdown pass on his first play of the game. Furman, however, stormed back to take the lead. But Elder a touchdown run. And then Jason Hunter forces a fumble on Furman's final drive, recovered and returned to the 1 yard line by Omar Byram, and Appalachian State advances. As for Northern Iowa, the Panthers hail from Cedar Falls, Iowa. They won the Gateway Conference with a school record 11 wins. And they've won each of their playoff games by 3 points, including two straight on the road at New Hampshire and last week at Texas State in overtime. And they trailed last week in the fourth quarter 37-29, but a David Horn touchdown. And then a 2-point conversion tied the game at 37. Texas State, despite three timeouts, decided to sit on the ball and play for overtime. A controversial decision we'll talk more about as we go along. Then in overtime, a field goal by UNI, and then Texas State turns it over. Matt Tharp with the interception, and the Panthers advance. Hi, everybody. I'm Dave Pasch alongside Rod Gilmore and Trevor Maddich. Stacy Dale Schumann will join us shortly. Well, fellas, a combined 25 playoff appearances between these two schools. And prior to last week, a combined 0-7 in the semifinals. But both Appalachian State and Northern Iowa able to overcome that obstacle and get to the championship game in Chattanooga. And Rod, as for you and I, you cannot spell unity without you and I, and that's been their mantra this year.
It has been. That's impressive. Good job out of you.
I practice about 100 times.
Almost as impressive as we've seen from you and I. And actually, that unity stuff is great, but you still need individual performances, some great ones. And they received it last week with their quarterback, Eric Sanders. He's only a sophomore, but he started lights out in that ball game. He was actually 10 of 10 on his first passes. He was outstanding. He finished strong as well, leading them to a game-tying drive in regulation, and then leading them to a game-winning field goal in overtime. And Trevor, I have to believe that his performance gives you and I an advantage at quarterback.
It does. Quarterback also key for Appalachian State. Backup Trey Elder played well off the bench last week when Richie Williams got hurt. But it's another thing entirely to be the starter with a full week for pressure to build. And Dave, there is no greater pressure than the national championship.
And both these schools, Trevor, trying to live out a dream on a dream field. Stacy Dale Schumann relives a nightmare from last year and tells us what's changed when we drop in on the national title game next. Welcome back to Chattanooga. Well, if you build it, they will come. And both Appalachian State and you and I have built championship programs, and the fans have come out to Finley Stadium to watch these two teams play. And Stacy Dale Schumann, they'll get a chance to play on a championship type field.
Yeah, Dave, there is one major difference this year besides the two teams, and that is that the field has changed. Last year at this time, it was basically a natural sod grass system. And because of really, really bad weather conditions and the wear and tear of cleats, it got completely ravaged, destroyed, as you all can see from the footage. All the locals, the county, the university basically said, we just can't have this. So they went to a nearby company called General Sports Turf Systems, its CEO, John Pritchett, and said, help us. He went on to create the only synthetic turf system of its kind in America, made up of polyethylene fiber, basically giving the natural look and feel of real grass. And interestingly, Dave, Pritchett is an alumnus of Appalachian State. So we'll see today if his crafty works give any advantage to his alma mater, guys.
All right, Stace, and the folks here in Chattanooga really rallying around this event. They came up in a local fundraising effort with around $300,000 for the installation of this beautiful field, one-of-a-kind artificial synthetic turf. It is an upgraded field turf, and this is the tryout for it here in Chattanooga. Jerry Moore has witnessed many a national championship game as a fan sitting in the stands here in Chattanooga. This is his first appearance in the national title game. And same goes for the walk-on from Waukon, Iowa. Mark Farley in his fifth year as the head coach, former player as well at Northern Iowa. Appalachian State will boot it away. Roush to do the honors from the 35. Goodwin and Dre Dokes are back to receive for Northern Iowa. And we are underway in the 2005 National Championship game in 1AA. Jamie Goodwin on the return to the 25-yard line. So Northern Iowa will start with the football, and sophomore quarterback Eric Sanders will try to do what he did last week, when he threw for 417 yards and four touchdowns, 17-2 as a starting quarterback, only five interceptions all year, 23 touchdowns, leads the country in pass efficiency.
He was so good at the start last season, his team jumped out to a 14-0 lead over Texas State.
He's got David Horn behind him in the backfield, and Horn will get it on first down. Makes Morrell miss and then gets planted by Zod Kelly along with Joe Suter. We mentioned David Horn. He's a transfer from Nebraska, set the UNI record this year with 18 touchdowns. He's joined in the backfield by Cyrus Garrett. Hunter, Surrency are the receivers, and Cutright the tight end. Reinhardt, Rollins, Hoffman, Anderson, and Lobdell up front. No seniors on the offensive line to start for Northern Iowa. And now Sanders out of the shotgun on second down and 8. And movement on the offensive line. Chad Reinhardt, the left tackle, was the man that moved.
We're only about 4 hours from Appalachian State. They have brought a lot of fans, and they are loud.
We have a Big Sky officiating crew here tonight, and we do have replay in effect for this game. They're using the Big Ten replay system. We have SEC replay officials, and again, Big Sky officials, and Bruce Palmer is the referee.
Defense in the neutral zone, causing the offense to false start. Number 97, 5-yard penalty, still second down.
So Jason Hunter was lined up in the neutral zone, and it'll go from 2nd and 8 to 2nd and 3. As we look at the Appalachian State defense, two terrific ends in Hunter and Morrell, combining for 22 sacks. The linebacking core, Kelly, West, and Smith. Touchdown, and Waze, the cornerbacks, Wiggins leading tackler for the Mountaineers, and Corey Lynch has 6 interceptions on the year. Second down, a little bit less than 3. And Sanders going to the sideline, complete to Surrency for a first down out of the 38-yard line. That is the 43rd catch for Surrency, the leading receiver on this team this year.
Well, that's pretty much the way Sanders started out last week, and as I mentioned before, he hit his first 10, and if he gets going like that, that opens up the running game, and they're tough on offense when that happens.
They are, and even blitzing him is difficult because he seems to get even better when he's under pressure.
He's completed 70% of his passes this year. Here's Horn to the outside. An excellent defense by Appalachian State as they run him out of play. The boundary corner, Jerome Touchdown, made the stop.
And Trevor, this is kind of what we're going to see. You're talking about a traditional offense that likes to run the ball against a really fast defense.
And when you have such a fast defense, you can't run successfully to the outside until you establish the run up the middle.
2-yard loss on the play. Sanders, a second-team All-Gateway performer. Missed a couple of games earlier this year with a high ankle sprain. Took over for an injured quarterback last year and won 8 straight, and that earned him a scholarship. Here he is rolling out, looking for throwing room, and he just throws it away. It was nearly picked off on the sideline by Brad West to try to make a diving attempt. Couldn't come up with it, and it'll bring up third down and long.
This is where Northern Iowa does not want to be. The two defensive ends, Jason Hunter and Marcus Morrell for Appalachian State, are first and second team All-Americans, outstanding pass rushers, and third and long is not the down and distance you want.
Yeah, they're not real big guys. They're athletic and fast. They come off the edge, and they're the key to that defense.
Sanders has a man wide open. It's Kurt Bradley, the son of former Major League Baseball standout Phil Bradley. Justin Woze was on the coverage, kind of. He was about 5 yards off of him. It's a 23-yard pass play and a first down.
Well, they have a lot of confidence in their front four, and they play a lot of man coverage. And you see right there the great move turning Wiggins around. Bradley with a nice route just beating the man coverage.
And great protection. That time the two defensive ends couldn't get there.
Columbia, Missouri native, a junior, Bradley for Northern Iowa. So they convert on third down and 12, and now it's first down at the Appalachian State 40-yard line. Back to the ground game in Horn. He has excellent feet, and he shows us that right there as he picks up 6 yards to the 34 before Jeremy Wiggins comes over to make the tackle.
You know, Trevor, we're going to get a pretty good contrast in offenses here. You're going to see this old-school kind of UNI attack and then a wide-open attack for Appalachian State.
Yeah, the Appalachian State might have been under center 4 times the entire year. They're a shotgun spread offense.
Horn on second and 4. Tripped up by Marcus Morrell. Horn still picked up a yard. Morrell, one of the top defensive players in all of 1AA football. First team All-American. That last name might sound familiar to you. His older brother Adrian spent 10 years in the National Football League as a running back.
If his brother was a running back, how does he wind up being a defensive end?
Well, if you want to hit your brother in the backyard, what better position?
I guess you're right. That'll do it.
Here's 3rd and 3. Play fake. Sanders in trouble. Morrell put pressure on him, and Sanders had to throw it away. 11 sacks and 5 forced fumbles on the year for Marcus Morrell. And what do you do if you're in Northern Iowa here on 4th down and 3?
Now, this is sort of no man's land. You know, you're at the 33-yard line. Probably not a good place to punt because you wind up kicking it into the end zone. It's a good area on the field where you can go for something without too much of a risk.
Well, they're going to try a field goal. Brian Wingert's long this year is 46 yards. This will be a 50-yard attempt.
Yeah, this is a little bit beyond his range.
So you don't like this call?
You know, it's early. You know, what the heck? It's better than punting.
And don't they have a safety back right there just in case it's short?
Well, this one has to let.
And it's good. Wow. Wow.
Brian Wingert, who has 3 game-winning field goals in the postseason so far, nails a 50-yarder on Northern Iowa's opening drive. So the Panthers strike first. Wingert from 50 yards up. So a career-long 50-yard field goal by junior kicker Brian Wingert, who has 3 game winners in 3 playoff games this year for Northern Iowa. A 9-play, 41-yard drive that converted a 3rd down and 12 on that drive.
You think he's not a little jacked up for this ball game, nailing that thing? And the other thing to note about that, last year he couldn't have made that kick because of the surface. This year he can. Better surface, good footing, he can nail a 50-yard.
As Stacy mentioned, in the open last year and in years past, really since the game came to Chattanooga, this field was just in horrible shape, but they were able to raise money for a new artificial surface here. It's an upgraded version of field turf. It's terrific. And Wingert obviously likes it. And here he's going to kick off to Dexter Jackson. And still has some leg left over after that 50-yarder. Jackson at the 15. Flag down, and Jackson lost the ball at the 24-yard line. Northern Iowa's football. Again, a penalty flag down, but the Panthers have it inside the Appalachian State 25.
Yeah, Trevor, looked to me like Jackson was bobbling that ball even before he got hit.
Corey Lewis came up with it, and it's a penalty on Appalachian State, so Northern Iowa will get the football inside the 25-yard line.
Well, he was doing a lot of things with his feet. All right, you're right, Rod. That ball came out before he was hit, but he's darting back and forth. He's juking. He's moving his hips. His balance point is changing.
He just loses his thing. This might be nerves or it could be cold weather, but he just loses it. That's quite surprising.
It is a chilly night here in Chattanooga. We've had a lot of rain over the last few days. Clear skies right now and temperature 38 degrees, very little wind.
This is a team that likes to go deep out of this trips formation to the left.
And there were a couple of deep balls for touchdowns last week against Texas State. There's a little inside pitch play to Breland, and Appalachian State was not fooled. Brad West made the tackle a couple of yards downfield.
And Rob, when you talk about contrasting styles of offense, deep passing is what they like to do. They like to pound the ball, but they don't have much of an intermediate or short passing game. When they throw it, they like to go over the top.
You know, they remind me of an SEC type of team. They like to pound the ball with a two back set, and then they like to toss it deep. That's their offensive coordinator's philosophy, Bill Salmon.
He is a native of Cedar Falls. He played at Northern Iowa, as did the head coach Mark Farley. They are UNI lifers and would love to see nothing more for the community to win a national championship. Beautiful throw by Sanders as he finds Hunter for a first down to the 12-yard line. Justin Woze on the coverage.
Woze is respecting Hunter's speed. He comes back underneath instead of going deep, and that's what creates the separation.
Well, we talked about Sanders getting off to a hot start. Look at this throw. I mean, where else would you want it? Right on the numbers and right on time.
We mentioned that Appalachian State has a backup quarterback scheduled to start tonight in Trey Elder. Nothing like starting for the second time and being perhaps down 14-0. First down at the 11. Sanders going to keep. Gets twirled down hard at the 9-yard line. That's a gain of about 3 on the play. Joe Suter made the tackle. Well, you guys talked about last season, the field in the James Madison, Montana championship game. And they had re-soldered it at the end of University of Tennessee Chattanooga's regular season. And here's the new field.
Now that is a fast track. What you saw before was a slow track.
And that helped James Madison, which is a rushing team, to pound the ball in all that mud and slush.
Quickly, who does it favor this year?
I think the fast track always favors the faster team, which is Appalachian State.
Second and 8. Sanders with a ton of time and throws errant. It was intended for David Horn off target, so it brings up third down at 8. And again, they can get a first down without having to get a touchdown. You see the numbers on Sanders from a week ago to start the game. 9 out of 9, 4 out of 7 so far tonight.
The guy who's been big for them down here, Trevor, Surrency, number 18.
Surrency not in the game right now. Two receivers to the near side. And Sanders got a throw on the run to the back of the end zone, incomplete. Hunter couldn't come up with it, and it'll be fourth down. Hunter had 2 touchdown catches last week. That pass a little bit too high.
Well, on his blind side, he had a double team on Jason Hunter, but the clock in his head said he didn't want to trust that double team too long. So he got rid of that ball, and I think that's smart early in the game.
Hey, if you're Appalachian State, your offense hasn't taken the field, but you might only be down 6-0. This is going to be a 26-yard try by Winger, who moments ago made a 50-yarder, and he buries this one. So Appalachian State fumbles on a kick return after a 50-yard made field goal. And all Northern Iowa can do is come up with 3 points. 6-0, UNI. Northern Iowa has outscored opponents now. It's 97-51 in the first quarter this year. Wingert has accounted for all 6 points in this game. 50-yarder and now a 26-yard field goal. And Jermaine Little, who has been injured for the last 2 months, will return this kickoff after Dexter Jackson fumbled the last one. Little was a first-team All-Southern Conference. Excellent return there. But he's going to take a knee here and not take a chance. We mentioned that Richie Williams, the Southern Conference Offensive Player of the Year, will not start the game at quarterback. Trey Elder will start the game. Here's the injury to Williams. Hurt his left ankle in the win over Furman. It was a ruptured tendon. He dressed. He warmed up. In fact, we saw him running around in pregame, so we might see him today. And here he is in pregame. But it is Trey Elder to start. It's only his second ever start, first of this year. He's a sophomore. And the play clock's at one. And they get it away. Richardson able to fight through one defender and actually pick up positive yardage. Jordan Lacey made the tackle after a gain of about two on the play. Elder last week threw for a touchdown on his first play since coming in for the injured Williams, but he also lost two fumbles in the game. One inside the 10-yard line. He's replacing one of the best players in all of 1AA. In fact, Williams was one of the semifinalists for the Walter Payton Award. Richardson again. He is a workhorse. Leading receiver and leading rusher. Takes it out to the 28. Charles Johnson made the tackle. Richardson with 1,382 yards rushing, 17 rushing touchdowns. Zach Johnson, Brandon Turner at wide receiver, along with Jermaine Little, Oliver Brown, Suttle, Robertson, and Eisenhower up front for Appalachian State. We mentioned they go no huddle on every play.
And shotgun.
Play fake to Richardson on third down and two. And nice attempt by Bettis, but he can't pull it in. It's incomplete. Tanner Varner came up with a big hit. Bettis saying he came up with it, but the officials say it's incomplete.
Bettis has a long ways to fall. He jumps high in the air, and Varner hits him, and he lands on his shoulder and on his neck. That hurts in this kind of cold.
We do have replay here tonight. But you got to come up with possession when you hit the ground, and the ball came out, so it's an incomplete pass. Dre Dokes is back to return the punt for Northern Iowa. Low snap, Dodge gets it away. Short kick. It takes a handful of healthy bounces for Appalachian State. It'll be downed at the 17-yard line. Saturday afternoon, ESPN2 delivers the NCAA Division III football championship as the University of Wisconsin-Whitewater takes on Mount Union Saturday at 1 Eastern time.
Yeah, I've done a few of those Division III championship games, and it seemed like every time I did one, the Purple Raiders of Mount Union were there.
And these are guys that play purely for the love of the game. I mean, even here in 1AA, you've got guys that can go to the NFL, but as you get into Division 2 and 3, they're playing for love.
Mount Union in its eighth title game in the last 10 years. Meanwhile, Wisconsin Whitewater is a perfect 14-0. Sanders with play action here on first down. And finds his man along the sideline. First down catch by James Lindgren. He had two grabs last week in the win over Texas State. Justin Wozay made the tackle on the play.
It's interesting what Northern Iowa is doing here, because the philosophy of Appalachian State is turn the defensive ends loose to rush the passer no matter what down and distance, and leave the corners back in one-on-one coverage, hoping you can get there before the ball can get out.
First down from the 28. It was a 55-yard punt that put Northern Iowa in this position. Here's Horn to the outside. Horn still on his feet, finally thrown down, and there might be a face mask. At the 48-yard line, Zod Kelly made the tackle for Appalachian State.
And David Horn is a very talented running back. Don't sleep on the fact that he's playing in Division I AA. He's a Nebraska transfer, really quick feet, makes decisive decisions to hit the seam and cut the ball up the field.
Personal foul, face mask on the defense, number 46, 15-yard penalty from the end of the run, first down.
So a 23-yard run, and then add 15 more to make it a 38-yard play. Horn had 651 yards as a freshman at Nebraska, but then Bill Callahan took over. His role was diminished, and you can play right away in college football when you transfer from a 1A school to a 1AA school. That's what Horn did, and he rushed for over 1,000 yards this season. Here's Freeney, the backup, takes it to the 30-yard line. Gain of 4 on the play. Marcus Morrell made the tackle. Final game of the year in 1AA, and it's the first time for Appalachian State and Northern Iowa in the championship game. First time since 1987 we've had two first-time finalists. Dave Pasch, Rod Gilmore, Trevor Maddich, and Stacy Dale Schumann here on another Freaky Friday in Chattanooga, Tennessee. On the second and six, play action. And Sanders going deep, and the pass is almost intercepted, incomplete. Justin Wose, who picked off 4 passes coming in, almost got his 5th of the year. Let's bring in Stacy Dale Schumann now.
Well, Dave, Rod talked last week against Texas State with Northern Iowa about unity, being unified, UNI, and boy, are they unified right now. This is a hungry team. They're playing like they have absolutely nothing to lose. It's not about the championship for this team, as they told us. It's about competing against Appalachian State tonight.
It's been such a wild ride, Stacy, to get here. You look at their last 6 game, guys. In 5 of those, they were down or tied in the 4th quarter, and they won all 5 of them, including last week at Texas State. Here, Sanders is sacked hard by Jason Hunter. 12th sack of the year for Hunter.
Well, this is this philosophy. Hunter's number 97 is gonna go inside and gonna just power right on through. The defensive ends are what Northern Iowa is concerned about here, because both Hunter and Morrell wreak havoc.
And that's a big play, because it pushes Northern Iowa out of field goal range. They had a 50-yarder earlier. Now they got to punt it away. Koss ready to boot it to Jeremy Wiggins. Wiggins letting it go. Northern Iowa's all over it at the 1-yard line.
And that was a great job. Now remember, in college football, it doesn't matter where your body is, it matters where the ball is. And as long as you keep the ball in the field of play, it's a good play.
Played perfectly by Dre Dokes. Appalachian State will take over at the 1. Further review.
After further review, the ball broke the plane of the goal line prior to possession. The result of the play is a touchback, 1st and 10 on the 20-yard line.
Let's take a look at it. Again, it's the ball, not the feet.
Yeah, just disregard where his feet are. Now, see how he starts to lean back? When he leans back, that may be when the ball breaks the plane. And had he not leaned back, it would have been a good play.
But I don't know how they can call that indisputable video evidence from that angle, because it has to be that in order to overturn it. From that angle, I think by definition, you couldn't make a call like that.
Really? It looked like from that angle, he was leaning back in the end zone.
Looked like he was leaning back, but I couldn't tell where the ball was.
Remember, guys, they are going to review every play in these games, and you wonder if in a championship game, they're going to take a little bit longer on each play.
But I think the change of possession helped them there. They had the timeout, the commercial timeout to look.
Not much there on the ground for Richardson, maybe a yard. Northern Iowa's defense, John Herman, the leader in sacks with 12 and a half, joined by Johnson Stinsrud and Lacey. Darren Heidemann is the leading tackler, along with Brett Kipke at linebacker. 5-man secondary, 3 safeties, Parsons, Varner, and Tharp. Dokes and Cooper are the corners. And Matt Tharp had his first career interception last week in overtime to seal the win against Texas State. Elder rolling out, has a man down the middle of the field. Caught at the 47-yard line by Brandon Turner.
Even though Elder doesn't have a lot of experience at this level, this offense is the same one he's run since the seventh grade. So the passing portion of it is something that he's used to reading defenses on, and he finds the right receiver.
26-yard pass play.
Hurry up offense, they will always get to the line of scrimmage, but that doesn't mean that they'll snap the ball right away.
Elder, the 2003 High School Player of the Year in South Carolina, finds TJ Corman to the 48-yard line for a yard. Michael Mathis on the tackle there.
Well, they've got three different speeds on this no huddle, Rod, and Stacy's been studying this all week.
Yeah, Trev, they do have three different speeds. The first speed they call jet. It's a hurry up offense. Obviously with the no huddle, they get right to the line and run their play. The second speed is indie. They get to the line real fast, guys, but then they take their time, and then they finally have the regular speed, which they're running right now, guys.
Play clock down to about three. Elder again looking middle, and that pass is broken up. It was intended for Bettis, and Chris Parsons made the play defensively, a converted quarterback, number 10 from Moore, Oklahoma.
I'm not sure I like the names that they use for their three different speeds. It seems to me that Indy, you don't hurry up and get to the line of scrimmage and stop. Indianapolis 500, you go. You go fast.
Unless they're talking about the Indianapolis Colts and Peyton Manning, because he'll get up there and call all kinds of plays.
And this is what you would call indie. They get to the line quickly, but then they call the play at the line. Here's 3rd and 9. Elder going deep. Oh, the pass was there, but Dexter Jackson couldn't haul it in. Good throw by Elder. Jackson, who turned it over on a kick return earlier in the game, could not come up with it, and it's 4th down and 9. And TJ Corman a little banged up on the play for Appalachian State. Matt Dodge to put it away here on 4th and 9.
You know, one of the things about that hurry-up offense, getting up to the line of scrimmage, that it hurts the big guys on defense, the linemen, because they don't get a chance to rest. They got to get right back in their stance.
And that's the difference between Jet and Indy. Jet is quick to the ball, quick snap. Indy, quick to the ball and wait.
Returnable for Dokes at the 9. Looking for the corner. Play at the 18-yard line by Billy Riddle. Wednesday night bowl season continues on ESPN with a battle of two high-scoring offenses. It's Toledo and UTEP and the GMAC Bowl. It's also available in sparkling high definition on ESPN HD. Bruce Gradkowski and Jordan Palmer. Two pretty good-looking quarterbacks going out in that game, guys.
Well, I also think it is the first return trip to Alabama for UTEP head coach Mike Price since the Crimson Tide fired him.
Price done a terrific job at UTEP since taking over there a year ago. On first down, it's Horn. He's got room to the outside. Stepped out of bounds right around the 26-yard line. Arthur Orlobar was the man that pushed Horn out of play after a gain of about 7.
This is impressive to me how Northern Iowa is able to run the ball, because Appalachian State will stack the box with extra run defenders, but not just to stop the run, so that both defensive ends don't even have to play the run. But there's still an extra guy in there, and they're getting run on anyway.
Yeah, that extra guy is a safety, and that's really helping them in run support. So they're going to have to take a shot down the field to loosen them up.
Horn on 2nd down. Again, we see the terrific feet, able to dance away from one would-be tackler and get the first down to the 30-yard line before Brad West comes up to make the play defensively.
Rod, you mentioned this turf, this surface. It's been raining all week, not today. But cuts like that cannot be made on wet grass with the kind of authority that they're made on this surface.
A generation of youngsters grew up watching Barry Sanders make those kind of moves, and they grew up trying those things in Pop Warner, Little League, and all those types of things. And you see it up here at this level now.
Horn again on 1st down. finds a hole. Finley dropped at the 37 after about 7 yards on the play. Tackled by Monte Smith and Omar Byram. Well, there have been a lot of guys that have played 1AA that have gone on to succeed in the National Football League. What do you guys think of Mr. Horn from what you've seen over the last 2 weeks?
Well, I think he's a talented running back. I really do. And I think he's versatile. He can catch the ball. I think the two things that might hurt him at the next level is that, one, he's not incredibly big, and two, he doesn't have flat-out difference-maker speed.
There's a pretty good number, though. Number 5, won by LaDainian Tomlinson. Might be the best back in the National Football League right now. Horn spun down about a yard shy of the first down by Brad West. So this will bring up third down and 1. Here are some notable 1AA players who have made it to the National Football League. Terrell Owens, who played here at University of Tennessee Chattanooga. Steve McNair, a top 10 pick at Alcorn State. Kurt Warner, Jimmy Smith, and Brian Westbrook, a former Peyton Award winner.
All those guys have played in the Super Bowl, haven't they?
Third down and 1. It'll be Horn, and he is leveled in the backfield. Jason Hunter with 9.5 tackles for a loss so far in the playoffs.
Well, right now, 97 Hunter is dominating this game defensively. They cannot handle him. He is a load for them to deal with, and they haven't found an answer yet. He comes inside, 2 guys, splits them, and still makes the tackle.
And Rod, the reason he's in there is pass rush, even though it's 3rd and 1. They ran into the back.
Speaking of guys who might play at the NFL level, Jason Hunter is one of them. A lot of teams like him perhaps as a outside linebacker in a 3-4 defense, as there is a penalty flag down here in 4th and 1. And this is against Appalachian State. It would be a first down for Northern Iowa.
We talk about the NFL guys. Wait for the call here.
Prior to the snap, false start on the offense, number 51, 5-yard penalty, still 4th down.
Appalachian State sent 3 guys to the NFL off of their 1995 team, and then they sent 4 off their 2000 team. And this year, they may have a couple of others with those ends that they have.
And the best player in terms of success at the NFL level coming from Appalachian State, St. Louis Rams linebacker Dexter Coakley. Adam Costa booted away. Boy, Northern Iowa struggling in 3rd down, just 1 out of 5. That saved Appalachian State so far in this game. Dexter Jackson gonna let this one go. And you and I will down it at the 35-yard line. Brian Cutright, the man that tagged it for Northern Iowa.
Well, Sean Elliott, the offensive line coach, that's a tough way to pump up your guys, you know. You make them hold you up in the air. Now, this is more like it. He's right in the middle of that drill. And something tells me if he gets hit in the head, he wouldn't even notice it. That's a guy that wants to still be playing.
You ever have anybody do that with you?
Absolutely. We used to have our offensive line coach at BYU get right in the middle of the drill.
Well, this is it. One chance to do it, right, in the championship game. Not much there for Elder, trying to take it off the right side. Charles Johnson, another good player who wears number 97 in this game. Johnson, a senior from Cedar Falls, Iowa, making the tackle on that play.
Right now, Johnson and his mates are having the better of the Appalachian offensive line right now. That firing up hasn't translated into a big drive yet.
Well, 3 of those 5 on Appalachian State's offensive line are first team all Southern Conference.
Elder to pass, flushed out. And Elder nearly threw an interception, then a reception, and then another interception. Thankfully, for his sake, it is incomplete. Bettis was the intended receiver. Jordan Lacey touched it first for you and I.
This is your classic tip drill. Everybody does this in 4 games and in practice. How do you react to the ball once it's in the air? That time, we tipped 3 times. You know, we haven't talked much about Richie Williams. He's not playing this ball game. The difference between Williams and Elder, Williams is so fast and quick, he's a difference maker. He can give you the big play. Elder plays well, but he doesn't give you the 50-yarder right away.
Well, Elder has got 3 interceptions with 5 touchdowns, throws a perfect pass there, complete to Jackson for the first down. Richie Williams' passing numbers are better, 20 touchdowns, 4 picks, but unavailable at least for the moment because of an ankle injury, and Trey Elder making his second career start in the biggest game for Appalachian State in its history, seeking its first championship in any team sport, first ever appearance in the title game for Northern Iowa after finally winning a semifinal game. They were 0-5 in the semifinals prior to last week's overtime win at Texas State. Elder, a late pitch to Richardson. Nice play defensively as he gets tripped up at the 48-yard line. Tanner Varner, the strong safety, who's accounted for 10 turnovers this year, made a great play there. That is the end of the first quarter in Chattanooga. 6-0 is your score. Northern Iowa leads Appalachian State in Chattanooga.
How do you rinse? If it's Listerine, you get a healthier mouth. Because adding Listerine to brushing and flossing reduces significantly more plaque. You can feel it working, killing germs, eliminating plaque. With Listerine, rinse any way you want. Take your routine beyond brushing and flossing. Add Listerine.
Your brother really wants a circular saw. S claws.
Oh, my brother.
Need a last-minute gift?
We're going to his house.
Head to the Home Depot. This handy Ryobi Air Grip Multitask Kit is only $39. It's 5 tools in one, from a laser level to a work light to a helping hand.
The Home Depot. You can do it, we can help.
This is the team that protects our members with the most comprehensive set of online safety tools. Because with high speed, the intruders come at you faster.
Right, yeah, but what about spam?
Oh, it's blocked.
Spyware.
Zapped.
Pop-ups.
Shut down.
Identity thieves.
Foiled.
Updates.
Automatically.
Viruses.
Crushed.
Extra cost.
Never.
Too many questions?
No.
Really?
Really.
The all-new Safety and Security Center with the most comprehensive set of automatically updating online safety tools. Want a better internet? You belong at AOL.
I can't believe I ate that whole thing.
Oh, where have I heard that before?
I can't believe I ate that whole thing.
Okay, I ate it.
I can't believe I ate that whole thing.
Take your Alka-Seltzer.
People overdo it. That's why for 75 years they've reached for Alka-Seltzer to break up and dissolve away stomach discomfort and pain fast.
Good night, dear.
Drop one crumb and you're dead.
Alka-Seltzer, a rich history of relief.
Anybody can fire a bullet. Few can actually steer it. Rated E for everyone.
So a pair of field goals in the first quarter for Northern Iowa, and it's a 6-0 game. Appalachian State has moved into UNI territory here in this beautiful new field in Chattanooga. Inside of the 1AA championship game, we will have a new champ this year. James Madison won last year, did not even get back to the playoffs. Neither of these schools has ever won a 1AA football championship. Little swing pass to Richardson, down to the 37-yard line. Gain of 11 on the play and a first down. Richardson with 50 catches on the year now to lead Appalachian State.
Well, Richardson will have to step up when you don't have a Richie Williams in the ball game, the quarterback. The quarterback is so important to this offense. It's a quarterback-oriented offense, and you need big plays from your quarterback.
And Richie Williams, the starter, who was the player of the year in the Southern Conference, is out with an injury now.
Williams was running around in pregame, so we might see him today, depending on how Elder does in here. Elder gets hammered. That's the second time today we've seen the head snap back and hit the turf. John Herman planted Elder on that play. With more on Richie Williams, let's bring Stacy in.
Dave, I asked Richie what his foot actually feels like. He said, it's very difficult to elevate on my toe. It's hard to raise up, jump. But he said, if I'm given the okay, I'm going to play in this game. I'm going to do anything to help the team.
He's the all-time leader in total offense in Southern Conference history. Great player as Elder makes a great throw, finding Dexter Jackson wrapped up by Dokes at the 35-yard line. Elder making his second career start today in place of the injured Williams. Time out for our Coca-Cola ESPN two-game track.
Well, pretty much fast start for you and I. Sanders, 5 of 10, setting up a couple of field goals, one following a turnover for them. Horn showing you his fancy footwork.
But Roger, talk about that fast start, and it's only 6-0. It seems like it should be 21-0. Just watch it.
Yep. It's big third down and 6 here for Appalachian State. Elder hit as he delivers, and it's pulled in inside the 10-yard line for a first down. Brandon Turner on the catch.
Well, Turner made the catch, but the play was made by Elder. He got a blitz right in the face, and he stood in there and delivered this thing. Watch, here comes a safety blitz. Tharp comes up, Varner number 20 in his face. And then you see right there, Tharp will get beat.
Didn't have any trouble elevating there, did he?
You better watch it, you might need that ankle.
First down and goal. Richardson breaking tackles and scoring. What a run! Touchdown, Appalachian State! Touchdown of the year rushing for Richardson.
And Richardson has been a huge spark plug for this team precisely because of that. The play broke down and he created the run.
Extra point is good from Roush. So Kevin Richardson scores, but Trey Elder made the big play. Hammered by Varner as he completes it 29 yards downfield, setting up a score.
Why do we love going out to eat? Being together with friends? Our favorite dishes? Yes. Introducing new Corner Bistro from Stouffer's. Restaurant-inspired entrees you can now enjoy at home. Try our full menu of new Corner Bistro entrees and see what's cooking at Stouffer's.
It's a four-hour drive or so from Boone, North Carolina, home of Appalachian State, seeking its first championship in any team sport. And it has the lead early second quarter on a touchdown run by Kevin Richardson. Roush to boot it away. Jamie Goodwin is back, along with Dre Dokes for Northern Iowa.
Well, and Trevor, I think you made the correct point a few minutes ago when you said that you and I dominated the first quarter, but only got 6 points out of it. Now they find themselves behind.
A low liner. Goodwin at the 15-yard line. And good return by Goodwin up to the 38-yard line. Monte Smith made the tackle.
Now Richardson will start to his right. The play breaks down. It stopped there. And then he comes back the other way. He keeps it alive. And that creativity on the move is what makes him so valuable.
And it's been an interesting story for the sophomore out of Elizabethtown, New Jersey, with Elizabethtown, North Carolina, rather. With more on that, here's Stacey.
Well, Dave, Kevin's progress is really impressive. He's just a sophomore. He walked on last year to this team. He was so out of shape. Coaches told us he couldn't even run two lengths up and down the football field. But, guys, he got up every morning, 6 a.m., and got the job done.
Zero scholarship offers. As that pass is incomplete, Jeremy Wiggins broke it up. Richardson walked on after nobody wanted him. And he had a pretty good high school career. What's interesting is he's caught 50 balls this year, guys. In his entire high school career, he caught two passes.
But you see, you wonder how a guy like this doesn't get any offers at all anywhere, and he has to walk on. He had an SAT score come in late after the signing day.
Second down and 10 for Northern Iowa. And Sanders on the keeper. Can't spin out of the arms of Marcus Morrell.
Well, we talked about the speed of this defense, and right now I think the two ends for Appalachian State are creating a problem for Northern Iowa. They haven't figured out how to handle them. They came in with the plan saying, well, we'll try and block them straight up and maybe we'll double, but they are not used to their speed off the edge yet.
Hunter and Morrell have combined for 23 sacks on the year, including one tonight, 7 forced fumbles and 6 fumble recoveries. Not to mention 3 touchdowns. And here's Hunter again, chasing Sanders, and Sanders makes the play. But Appalachian State is going to take down the tight end Cutright about 6 yards shy of a first down. Monte Smith made the tackle, but it was Hunter who was in the face of the quarterback once again.
Yeah, he is so fast. They never know where he's going to go or even necessarily how to slide for him. You see the speed he uses to get inside, and he splits 2 blockers again. They haven't figured out how to handle him yet.
Adam Cost to boot it away to Dexter Jackson. And fair caught at the 12-yard line. So good punt by Cost, pinning Appalachian State deep in its own territory. Appalachian State by 1. Hey guys, we're just a couple of weeks away from the BCS bowl game, so we'll talk about some of those when we come back.
Introducing the all-new Suzuki Grand Vitara. You want more out of life? Suzuki's giving you the green light. Go! Lease the all-new Suzuki Grand Vitara for just $199 a month for 30 months. Hurry in. Breakfast Bistro Sandwich. Sonic's got it, others don't. Start your morning with Sonic's new Breakfast Bistro Sandwiches. Eggs and cheese with bacon, sausage, or ham on Sonic's new toasted ciabatta bread. Buy a reloadable My Sonic card today and give the gift of great food.
Today.
Oh, you're hot.
Thank you, so are you. It's 4 against 1.
Let's not fight.
No, let's.
In the hottest DVD of the year.
Wow.
Fantastic Four. Own it today.
You've been working out.
Shut up.
NCAA Championships on ESPN. The Division I AA Football National Championship game is brought to you by Coca-Cola. Make it real.
Back in Chattanooga, Tennessee, a battle for a national championship between two schools making their first ever appearance in the title game. And they have been to the playoffs a combined 25 times. Prior to last week, 0-7 combined in the semis. But here they are in the championship game for the first time. And even though Appalachian State has the turnover, it's the Mountaineers with a one-point lead on the Panthers early second quarter. Appalachian State taking over at the 12-yard line, and Richardson can't hang on to the screen pass. Incomplete. It'll bring up second down and 10. Well, guys, we're just a few weeks away from the Rose Bowl presented by City, Texas, and USC. And Heisman Trophy winner, Reggie Bush.
You say that like you were surprised that Bush ran this,
surprised.
You know. So who's going to win, Texas, USC?
I would give the edge right now to USC, playing it at home essentially down there in Southern California. And I think defensively they're getting healthier and they're getting back to where they were early in the season.
I want Trevor's take after this play. Elder looking for running room. He had trouble hanging out of the ball last week. Fumbled three times, lost two of them. Charles Johnson made the tackle there after a gain of three.
You would think that USC would be diminished a bit by hearing how great they are, and Texas would be elevated by hearing how USC is going to win. But Pete Carroll has been spectacular during this entire winning streak of over 30 games at keeping his team focused and preparing every week, and I think USC has the edge.
That's January 4th at 8 Eastern on ABC.
I thought certainly you were leaning towards Texas a little bit, Matt Baldwin.
And we've got a whistle. No play. No play. It was stopped by the field judge. And they completed the pass, but the field judge was waving his arms. And it looked like there was some movement on the Appalachian State side of things.
You know, while they sort that out, and one other comment on that Rose Bowl game.
Prior to the snap, timeout was requested by Northern Iowa. No play. That's their first charge time.
The Northern Iowa fans are booing Bruce Palmer for calling him Northern Idaho.
The other thing I want to point out about the Rose Bowl game is that Vince Young had such a fantastic game last year in that game. I was there and watched him, and it was phenomenal. You wonder if there isn't this sense or feeling for him that that's his stadium and that he may feel like he owns it, and it may give him a certain amount of confidence going back to play there.
And you know, the thing that he brings to it is that he has improved dramatically as a passer. Last year it was mostly as a runner, although he did pass well, that brought that amazing comeback. This year, however, if USC is able to stop his improved passing, he still can pull it down and take off.
I tell you what, I think it's going to be probably the best national championship game that we've seen in quite a while. Not hard to improve over last year's, though. USC smoked Oklahoma.
That's another reason why it's hard for me to go with anybody other than USC, just because it's been so long since they've lost that it's hard to go into the trap that they are weak on defense or they have injuries in the secondary, and we've been saying that for 2 years.
Well, guys, if you're Reggie Bush, you want a Heisman now, there's a good chance you'll be the number one overall pick in the NFL draft. But that was the case with Matt Leinart last year, and he elected to come back and play his senior year at USC. Now, maybe the difference with Bush is Leinart is not returning, where Leinart knew that Reggie Bush would be there when he came back last year.
Well, I think the circumstances are very different. I think Leinart won a quarterback. There's less likelihood of injury. And two, I think Leinart's arm was a little bit of an issue for him. I think he wasn't completely healthy, and he wasn't going to show that well at the combines. He might have had to sit out for some of that stuff. I think Bush, coming back as a running back, you've got a higher injury risk factor, and he's healthy. You ought to go.
Yeah, I agree with you, Rod. I mean, and being the number one or number two pick in the draft, he can't go higher. He owes it to his future children to cash that check while he's healthy.
It's definitely a Freaky Friday because you guys just agreed. All right, third down and 7 here after a timeout and then a resetting of the game clock to 11 minutes. Elder has time and finds a man across the middle for the first down. Zach Johnson. Out to the 32-yard line, the junior from Charlotte, North Carolina, gets the first down. Dave Schratz on the tackle.
Elder had his eyes on Johnson the entire way. He was working against safety Tanner Varner, and that is a mismatch in favor of Appalachian State.
So first down for Appalachian State at the 33-yard line, a 37-yard line, I should say. There's a pass that's underthrown. Varner tried to pick it off, and he is able to come up with it for the interception. Third INT on the year for Tanner Varner for UNI.
He had his eyes on Tanner Varner's man, Zach Johnson, the entire time. This time, he has his eye on Tanner Varner's man again. And this time, Varner reads the eyes and jumps in front of Dexter Jackson.
A Mountaineer fan made the trip from Boone, North Carolina, to watch Appalachian State. Sanders will come out for Northern Iowa. Meanwhile, Elder and Williams are talking things over on the Appalachian State sideline.
And Williams is teaching him a little something there.
And they go back to their money man, David Horn. Gain of about 2 to the 39, tackled by Kelly.
Another thing that he's doing, Richie Williams, is keeping the coaches away from him, because he told us yesterday, Williams did, that he doesn't like himself to have coaches in your ear after a mistake. Get coached up and then let him move on.
Yeah, but when you misread a coverage and there's a safety flying out to the flat and you don't see it, the coach is going to tell you. He's going to come tell you, you cannot make that mistake.
Two turnovers by Appalachian State. But the Mountaineers still lead for now. Sanders going deep down the sideline. And it's caught inside the 10-yard line. Jamie Goodwin able to pull it in at the 7-yard line. Jerome, touchdown on the coverage. Was that pass underthrown on purpose?
Might have been. We've talked about the deep ball, that Sanders excels at this. This is their offense. A little push off there. And Goodwin comes back to catch it. He was silent last week. Had a big game a couple of weeks ago against New Hampshire. But that ball, he did catch it inbounds there. Little push off he got away with.
33-yard reception for Jamie Goodwin, a transfer from Akron in his only year at Northern Iowa, trying to win a championship. Hand off to Freeney, the fullback. And he gets to the 5. Freeney had 2 straight 1,000-yard seasons prior to this year, but relegated mostly to a backup role of late due to an injury and also the emergence of David Horn. Jason Hunter made the tackle for Appalachian State on the play. Northern Iowa in its first ever title game. We talked with Mark Farley, the head coach, this week, and he said, you know, there's so much tradition at this school, so much so that each player has to remember that he is playing for guys in the past that wore their respective numbers. Sanders off the play action rolling out. Sanders gonna keep and get sandwiched at the 2-yard line. Sanders wearing number 12, a guy that wore number 13 at Northern Iowa, perhaps the best player ever there, 2-time MVP Kurt Warren.
The other thing that Farley told us was that the whole state has gotten behind their program. If you're an Iowa fan, Iowa State fan, they have no problem getting behind UNI. And when they left to come down here, their send-off, they had some 500 people surrounding their bus. They needed a police escort to get out of the stadium parking lot.
Farley, a former Gateway co-defensive player of the year in his 5th year as head coach. Here's Horn on 3rd down, and he's in! Touchdown, Northern Iowa! David Horn adding to his record, 19th touchdown of the year with a senior from Omaha, Nebraska.
The number 33, Terrence Freeney, the other tailback who has been out for much of the year limited because of an ankle injury, blocked for Horn from fullback.
The extra point sails through, kind of awkward off the foot of Wingert, but it's good nonetheless. And Northern Iowa capitalizes on Tanner Varner's interception. David Horn with a touchdown for UNI.
On the joyous days of old, my TV gives to me the best college games you'll ever see. There's nothing else like bowl week that you'll ever see. Tailbacks are sweeping, quarterbacks are throwing whistles of ball. Coaches screaming, four down and long. Three wide
has been to a retired fans football feast. It's the best we've gone to.
Capital One Bowl Week, December 26th and January 2nd on ESPN and ESPN2.
What are your favorite NFL players doing this holiday season?
Playing football, of course. NFL Sunday Ticket Special Offer from DirecTV. Catch the rest of this year's heart-pounding action. Plus, get next year's entire NFL regular season. All for just $239 or four payments of $59.75. 'Tis the season for giving, receiving, and celebrating. 'Tis the season for NFL Sunday Ticket, only from DirecTV.
Get all the college hoops you can handle with the ESPN Full Court Pay-Per-View Package.
Unbelievable!
More than 450 games you want to see.
Yes!
Top conferences. Critical matchups you won't get without ESPN Full Court.
To order, visit DirectTVSports.com or call 1-800-GET-SPORTS.
David Horn with a touchdown run for Northern Iowa. His 17th rushing score of the year came off a interception, and 10 of the 13 points in the game for Northern Iowa coming off the turnover.
Yeah, Tanner Varner set that up with a diving interception, which shortened the field. And you and I cashed that one in. It's 10 points off turnovers. Big difference in the ballgame right now.
Rod, you talked about that deep strike passing game. They went right straight for that deep strike and got it to set up the touchdown.
And a big pass play to Jamie Goodwin set up that score on a third down and goal from the two. Winger to kick off. Jermaine Little fractured his fibula back on November 5th against LSU. Still named to the first team All-Southern Conference. Is back to receive. He's playing tonight with 8 screws in his foot. They try to kick away from him. It's placed perfectly, but Little able to still make something out of it. Little up to the 29-yard line. A lot of pads popping in this Division I-AA championship game. And there were some pads popping in practice for Appalachian State on Monday back in Boone, North Carolina.
Yeah, usually a little bit unusual to find teams that will pad up 2-3 days during the week, as these guys did. A lot of teams would prefer not to do that this late in the season.
Northern Iowa just practices in shells and helmets. They don't go full pads.
Now they've been doing that for 3 weeks. They took off the pads close to a month ago. Kind of like an NFL team. Inside handoff on first down and nowhere to go for TJ Corman. Wrapped up by Kevin Stensrud. For more on pad versus no pad, let's bring Stacy in.
Well, Dave, last week when we covered Texas State and Northern Iowa, we talked about or reported about the pro-style practices. Very little pad use, very little contact. Well, they were watching this football game last week, Appalachian State, and the players started snickering. And Coach Moore said, I knew I had something special in my players. We practice in pads, and I've got a tough bunch, Dave.
Yeah, they were laughing, thinking, those guys aren't wearing pads. We've been padding up all season long and aren't going to stop. Brandon Turner on the catch and Varner on the tackle out at the 31-yard line. Gain of 4 on the play. Going to bring up third down and 8.
But, you know, you have to know your team. If you pad up your team for 2 or 3 days a week and it's a team that would respond with, why are we doing this? And that's not going to work. You have to understand what kind of guys you have. Otherwise, you might have a mutiny.
But those Appalachian State players have rallied around Jerry Moore. That pass tipped at the line. Incomplete. Little was the intended receiver.
And Rod, you talk about knowing your team. A lot of that has to do with the fact that Jerry Moore has a very young team. There's only about a dozen seniors on this team, and so he wants to keep the routine in for the young players because they're accustomed to pads, 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 shells, game, and he wants to keep that rhythm.
Matt Dodge to punt it away. Dre Dokes is back at the 30-yard line to return.
Personally, I prefer to give up the pads late in the season.
Wobbly kick, and Dokes in traffic makes the fair catch at the 40-yard line. So you would take him off.
Well, I think most skill position guys, receivers, defensive backs,
you know, want to play fast, want to get healthy, and would like to do without the hitting the later you get in the season. I don't know about you big guys.
No, the big guys don't like it either, really. Although, except for one thing, big guys do like to have live run drills with pads, then take them off. They don't like the drill, but they like what it gives them, that rhythm with the running back.
Well, right now, no pad is leading pad by six. Although Pat makes a pretty good play there as David Horn is stood up by Monte Smith. There's a loss of a couple on the play. Monte Smith, we talked about the wearing of number and remembering that you had a guy before you that wore it. Well, a guy by the name of Dino Hackett, remember him? Great college player, went on to play for the Kansas City Chiefs. Well, they're going to retire his number after the season, so Monte Smith's going to have to get a new number next year.
Can't they grandfather him in or something, let him go another year with it?
Smith, only a junior from Shelby, North Carolina. Appalachian State has never won a title in any team sport since athletics started back in 1903 in Boone, North Carolina. Sanders, magician-like, somehow getting out of there and getting close to midfield. Tackled by Jason Hunter on the play. Going to bring up third down and short.
Well, Jason Hunter's right up here working on Grant Oliver. And he comes all the way back down and gets an amazing tackle way down the field.
Jason Hunter's been all over the field tonight. Sanders out of the shotgun here on third and short. Sanders, the nation's leader in pass efficiency in 1AA. Hit again as he throws, and he's got his man for the first down, the 47-yard line. James Lindgren on the catch, and Touchstone was right there in the coverage and made the play along with Arthur Olivar, but still a first down for UNI. Sanders makes another play despite getting cracked as he releases it.
Well, he's been spectacular in the postseason. Fast start last week, fast start the week before that, hanging in there. He's completed passes to seven different receivers and tough in the pocket.
He is 17-2 as Northern Iowa's starting quarterback. And he did not get a scholarship until after last year when he won eight straight in relief of the normal starter who was injured. Jason Hunter again makes another play as he just eats up David Horn at the point of attack. Maybe a yard on the play.
I'm surprised that you and I can't run the ball better on this defense.
Well, teams have run the ball on this defense. The key is that Mario Verduzco has got his quarterback able to take advantage with the pass. And one of the things he does, even with walk-ons like Eric Sanders, is gives them the same attention in meetings and preparation as he gives the starter. And that's one of the reasons that Sanders is developing early. He's ahead of where sophomores should be.
Sanders on second and nine takes the low snap. He's dangerous rolling out. And he's able to complete it, but it's dropped. Incomplete. Breland had it, then lost it. And they're going to rule it incomplete. Justin Wose broke up the pass. Let's bring Stacy in for more on Eric Sanders.
No, Trevor, not only does quarterback coach Verduzco give these guys time in meetings and give them equal opportunity, he gives them a nine-page exam or final two nights before the game, and they have to go through and take that test, and he grades them on it, but he only grades them in making them better. He doesn't really get down on them about it. He's very positive with them, and he's always stressing even keel to Eric Sanders.
Well, he is a little bit of a different guy. As I saw the sunglasses, although those might be amber vision. They just get dark at night. Here's Sanders on third down, getting out of trouble, and then finally tripped up at the 45-yard line by Joe Suter, going to be short on the first down.
When Verduzco sees his quarterback under pressure like that, I'm sure he wishes that those were opaque. Actually, he wears sunglasses not because he thinks he's cool, but because his eyes are especially light sensitive. I remember Jim McMahon always wore sunglasses, and everybody thought that he was into himself, but McMahon was poked in the eye with a fork when he was a kid. And Verduzco, sensitive.
Adam Costa booted away. Dexter Jackson is back to receive at the 10-yard line. Jackson going to let this one go into the end zone. Come on, it had to be a combination of McMahon wanting to be cool along with that. Come on.
Well, that doesn't mean he wouldn't have worn them anyway.
Are you making up the fork thing?
No, that's a true story.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
And he looks cool in the glasses.
High the utensils, 13-7, you and I.
This is history in the making.
Drop that old school.
Yeah, boy.
That's what I'm talking about right there.
I see you, little man. Yeah.
Okay.
Dead or Alive 4, coming soon, only for the Xbox 360.
Throw is tough. It isn't just you against a 9-pound ball. It's you against yourself. It's pure concentration, and you have to dig deep inside to find every throw. It's brutal. I had to study biomedical engineering just to relax.
There are over 360,000 NCAA student athletes, and just about all of us are going pro in something other than sports.
And welcome back to Chattanooga. All right, Rod and I, Trevor, are going to come up with a couple of bucks each if you'll sing the Chattanooga Choo Choo song.
Yeah, you're going to keep your money, but I will give you the whistle. Woo woo!
All right, here's a nickel. That was a pretty weak effort.
Well, it's my only whistle.
After the touchback, Appalachian State starts at the 20-yard line. And the ball is out. Fumble at the 25-yard line. And Northern Iowa comes up with its third takeaway. Trey Hennessy, who didn't even play last week because of an injury, gets his first handoff of the game. He fumbles, and Matt Tharp, with a game-winning interception in overtime last week against Texas State, comes up with it.
Well, Trevor, that's the last time the Appalachian State people are going to let you choo-choo whistle and whatnot. Probably scared these guys. The ball just jumps out.
Yeah, it was stripped out in the middle, and Tharp, who recovers it, has a broken finger on his right hand. You see on his wrist over there, he's got a thin cast, the same cast he was wearing when he got the winning interception in overtime last week. He should wear that always.
Well, that's a key situation there for a freshman running back who didn't play last week in a championship game to get his first carry of the game when you're at your 20-yard line. David Horn takes it to about the 24 for 4 yards on the play.
Well, you had two fumbles, which really didn't appear to be caused by you and I. I mean, not big hits or anything. They just lost the ball, young players, and a pick by their quarterback, three turnovers. You and I has taken advantage of that, 10 points. Now they have a chance to get 7 more here off a turnover. And Hennessy is just beside himself.
Formation here on 2nd and 6. Toss to Horn. Here comes the reverse. And Appalachian State not fooled. Marcus Morrell. Morrell and Hunter are controlling things defensively for Appalachian State once again tonight.
And remember, when you see this penetration from those defensive ends, they are not playing the run here. What they're playing is the pass. Now, Morrell's going to come right straight up as if he's rushing the quarterback. And then he reads the run and reacts. But that's why he gets that penetration. Why can they do that? Because they stack the box with other players to make up for run.
Yeah, they tell those guys, go ahead, rush the passer every play, and the rest of the guys will play run. 3rd and 17. Sanders looking deep. And he's got it inside the 15. Justin Cerency, who's had a quiet night, the go-to guy for most of the year, receiver for UNI, makes the play inside the 15-yard line for a first down.
It's a threat of the deep ball that opens this up. You'll see space in front of the deeper guys and behind the shorter guys. Cerency found that soft spot, and Sanders found Cerency.
So they convert on third down and 17. As you look at the numbers for Sanders tonight. Horn looking for a hole. Can't find it. Got maybe a yard on the play. Brad West, a senior from Clemson, South Carolina, made the tackle.
And we talked about Cerency earlier in the ball game, and he always seems to be in position to make a big catch for this team. You know, he made that two-point conversion catch last week to tie the game against Texas State and send it into overtime. The guy says he's learned an awful lot from training with Larry Fitzgerald of the Arizona Cardinals, a fellow guy from Minnesota.
Second down and 8, and Sanders will go out of the gun here. Sanders fakes the handoff, keeps, and Morrell is all over him. Loss of 2 on the play. Morrell and Hunter have tied the team lead in tackles so far in this game with 5 each. We've got the 1AA football championship tonight. The Division III national championship is Saturday at 1 Eastern on ESPN2. For a preview, visit NCAAsports.com, the official online home for all 88 NCAA championships. A huge third down and 11. They've already converted a third down and 17 on this drive. This is big for Appalachian State. Minus 3 right now in turnover ratio. Sanders in trouble. And throws it away. So Northern Iowa will have to settle for a field goal try.
And credit this defensive stand to those two ends, Hunter and Morrell. And they were both back in the backfield that time against Sanders. And you know something? Those guys, those big tall guys, are both better athletes than Sanders. They can outrun him, which is why they're giving him a lot of trouble in the backfield.
See the numbers for Winger. So far tonight, Winger 2 out of 2, including a 50-yard field goal. This is a 31-yard attempt. And he nails it. Well, Appalachian State is minus 3 in turnover ratio, but they're only down 9 points late in the second quarter to Northern Iowa. Appalachian State tied the school record with 10 turnovers in the regular season. They've lost 10 fumbles in the playoffs, including 2 in this game. Dexter Jackson on a kickoff following a field goal for Northern Iowa. And Hennessy coughed it up. And also an interception of the game for Tanner Varner. However, it's only a 9-point deficit for Appalachian State.
And Dave, that's huge, because in a game like this against evenly matched opponents, it's very rare for one team to dominate the momentum the entire game. When it's on your side, you need to get touchdowns.
The last minute and change could be interesting, because the coaching box for Appalachian State has lost power. Mountaineers are going to take a knee as Little downs it about 8 yards deep in the end zone. Check with Reese Davis in the studio. He's going to tell us what's coming up at the half.
All right, guys, Jim Donnan alongside as well. Dan Hawkins, now the head Buffalo of Colorado. At least he will be officially after the first of the year. We'll talk about that. We'll put out a format for a 1A playoff. There's a novel concept, and look ahead to the Division III championship game.
Hey, don't miss that 1A playoff. I'm going to tell you who's going to win the national championship.
How about that? Predictions from Jim Donnan and Joe Shad will also stop by with some news. We'll see you in a few minutes.
Some more coaches hired today, and there's a report that Chuck Long will be the head coach at San Diego State, the offensive coordinator at Oklahoma. Richardson to about the 22 for 2 yards. Jordan Lacy on the tackle.
And with Dan Hawkins going to Colorado, not a surprise. You take a look at that graphic there showing you the changes. Well, Hawkins, not a surprise, because he was always concerned about his coaching staff being able to live in the area in which they would move to. And high-profile jobs looked at him last year, but he thought those areas were too expensive. He can take his staff, or a lot of that staff, with him to Colorado.
Richardson, may have been a face mask there. Richardson didn't get much. Heideman on the tackle, but again, a flag down. We'll see if this is a 5 or a 15-yard face mask.
Roger, talk about Dan Hawkins at Colorado. He is the ultimate in integrity. And Colorado has had so many problems with recruiting scandals and run-ins with the law over the last several years. Hiring someone like Hawkins is almost a statement that this will no longer be the image of Colorado football.
Maybe this changes your philosophy a little bit.
Personal
here, guys, because of the personal
face
foul face mask.
Defense number 99,
15-yard penalty added to the end of the run. Automatic first down.
It looked like Appalachian State was just trying to run the ball and avoid turnovers, but now you've got a little bit more room. You have all your timeouts.
Yeah, we'll get to that. Go back to this list, and, you know, you do have to make note of the fact that there are a couple of African-American coaches hired, Turner Gill at Buffalo, Ron Prince at Kansas State. A huge improvement in college football in just a couple of weeks.
Well, apparently Appalachian State just going to play for halftime, so to speak. And we do have a timeout. Let's see who called it, though. Called by Appalachian State, which is a little bit odd after a running play. And there's 19 seconds left. So 19 seconds left, both teams with two timeouts remaining, and Northern Iowa leading 16-7. Well, you mentioned Turner Gill. He's going to be the new head coach at Buffalo, former player at Nebraska. And Jerry Moore, the head coach here at Appalachian State, coached at Nebraska in the mid-70s under Tom Osborne, for whom Turner Gill played.
And you've got to wonder if the success of African-American head coaches in the NFL is starting to open up some eyes in the college world. Right now, the best team in the league, Indianapolis Colts, Tony Dungy.
Mm-hmm. Well, the top three candidates in the NFL for Coach of the Year are all African-American: Tony Dungy, Marvin Lewis at Cincinnati, and Lovie Smith with the Chicago Bears.
Yeah, I think you can certainly say that Kansas State opened up, and that's a pretty good job. The Buffalo job, that hasn't been a great one, and obviously Turner Gill wants a shot at being a head coach, and historically African-American coaching prospects have had to take jobs like Buffalo to get a shot.
Jim Hoffer was let go after he did his best to try to win at a very tough place to win up at UB. And now they come out throwing, and it's caught inside the 45, and they got two timeouts left. It's pulled in by Zach Johnson. Parsons made the tackle. They can still run a play, call another timeout, and then try a field goal.
And Julian Roush, the kicker, has a very strong leg. He can hit him out to 50 yards.
Well, there you see, just flooding one area of the field with a couple of receivers running off the coverage, and then having one receiver remain in that hole, that dead spot. Pick up a first down, give yourself a shot with 11 seconds to go here.
There's Julian Roush warming up. His long this year is 39 yards, and he's only 3 out of 10 from 30 plus on the year.
But the reason for that is not because of leg strength, it's because of accuracy. And so if you've got to take one shot at the end of the half, he'll get it there. The question is, will it be straight?
Well, since you have the timeout, you can throw the ball down the middle of the field. You don't have to work the sidelines. You really only need, oh, probably 12 yards, 13 yards to have a legitimate shot. That would give you about a 46, 47-yard field goal attempt.
And by the way, they have fixed the problem in the coaching box for Appalachian State. Had lost power, and you know why, guys? Because the on-field coaches accidentally kicked the wires loose.
Out of frustration?
Sure, that sounds good. So first down to the 43. A sack is what they don't need. That's what they're going to get, though. And that might end the half. John Herman, the leader in sacks on the year for Northern Iowa, takes down Elder at the 43. No time left on the clock. Let's see if Appalachian State was able to call for time before the clock ran out.
Timeout called by Appalachian State with 2 seconds on the clock. That's their last timeout of the half.
But because of the sack, obviously they're out of field goal range, and they couldn't even get into field goal range here with just 2 seconds left. So they've got to get it downfield and get a Hail Mary. We had some timeout issues last week in our game with Northern Iowa and Texas State, as Northern Iowa blew all of its timeouts early in the second half. Texas State had all of its timeouts left, had a senior quarterback, and was tied after Northern Iowa scored late in the game. A touchdown and then a two-point conversion, not of the game at 37. Texas State took over, had plenty of time left, instead played for overtime.
You just can't do that. You have to give those young men an opportunity to try and win the game in regulation. You see, there was the pick at the end of the ball game by Tharp, which ended it. Texas State did not take a shot with 1:27 to go in three timeouts, and you have to believe in your players to give them a shot, Trevor.
That's unfortunate for head coach David Bayless, because he's been a very good coach.
Richie Williams, who is injured, is going to come into the game, and Northern Iowa sees that and calls a timeout. The Southern Conference Offensive Player of the Year is not starting tonight because of a ruptured tendon in his left ankle suffered last week against Furman in the first quarter, but is getting a chance to play here, and the question is why.
Yeah, I don't get this at all. I mean, he's injured. He's sat on the sideline for what, about an hour and a half now. It's gotten colder, and you bring him in for a two-second play where you really have nothing to gain except a Hail Mary. I mean, if you're going to play the guy in the second half, let him warm up and play him in the third quarter.
Ron, I like this decision, though. And I'll tell you what. This is not a play where he would scramble. There's no way he will scramble for a touchdown. He's going to sit back and unload the ball, and his arm is stronger than Trey Elder. And I like it that Jerry Moore is going for it.
He's been sitting on the sideline for a long time. I don't care how strong his arm is. He's got a bad ankle. And if you want to play the guy, I mean, give him some good conditions to come in and play. Don't put him in a desperate situation like this.
By the way, I was worried. I'm glad to see it's back to normal up here. Disagreeing.
Well, this timeout does help him. It gives him another half a dozen throws to warm up.
I'm going to agree with Trevor here. I don't mind this at all. He's got the arm strength to get it. All you do is drop back and heave it up. It doesn't matter how long he's been on the sideline.
Oh,
the chances of completing this pass are slim to none. Throw it up there.
How cold is it? What'd you tell me? 36 degrees?
So here goes Williams. He uncorks it. And that is down inside the five. Oh, and they're in position. It was incomplete. It almost got redirected to Brandon Turner. Drake Doakes broke it up, and Williams will hobble to the locker room. And Doakes is hurt, or at least slow to get up, after breaking up that pass, and he's a starting cornerback. And they're gonna have to carry him off. Mark Farley, the head coach for Northern Iowa, standing by with Stacy.
Coach, why was your defense successful turning Appalachian State over a team that doesn't typically do so?
Well, right now we're playing good, hard football. Our defensive line is doing a great job. We just had some breakdowns in coverage.
What's the key to the second half?
Right now, stay determined like we are. We have to finish this thing. We have to get stronger in our coverage, and again, we still have to be able to rush the football.
All right, thanks, Coach. Dave?
All right, Stacy, you saw that stat, 9-0 when leading at half, but five times this year they've been down. Appalachian State has pulled within two midway through the third quarter, scoring on its second possession of the third quarter. A nine-play, 79-yard drive. Richardson with another touchdown as the injured quarterback Richie Williams goes 4 for 5 on that drive for 64 yards. Jamie Goodwin with it now on the kick return for Northern Iowa. Able to somehow get around that wall of Appalachian State players to the 23. And that is where Northern Iowa will take over. And last week, 417 passing yards, only 116 tonight. And the yards after the catch cut down only 11 tonight after 100 last week for Mark Farley's crew.
13 of their 16 points come off of Appalachian State turnovers. And when they had the momentum in the first half, they scored field goals instead of touchdowns. And here we are with the momentum on the opposite side of the field.
Sanders' numbers, not nearly what they were a week ago. But he hasn't played poorly. First down from the 24, play action. And Sanders flushed out again. Those two terrific defensive ends. Sanders, though, makes something out of it. All the way to the 34. He got close to 10, maybe 11. Yep, gonna have the first down. Again, though, Morrell was in there. The left defensive end, but Sanders made a better play.
But you know, some of the great things you get, this is what you get in a playoff. A playoff system, we've got two teams here that nobody expected to be here, unlike a bowl system, and you got guys playing what could be their last game. You got a guy, a quarterback for Appalachian State, limping around out there. You have a sophomore quarterback here for UNI trying to do what he's done the last 3 weeks, bring his team back.
And we'll talk in our Friday night debate the merits of a playoff system, not only at the 1AA level, but at the 1A level as well, as Horn picks up another first down. Monte Smith made the tackle about 12 or 13 yards downfield.
Rod, you talk about the pressure these kids have been under. You have to win three playoff games to get to this national championship game, and they are different from bowls, because a bowl game, you know, is your last game. In the playoffs, you win, you move on. You lose, you go home. The pressure is much higher.
Each team playing tonight has three losses on the year. Look at that Division III championship game tomorrow. There's only one loss combined between those two schools playing. Horn stiff arms a defender and slips at the 45-yard line. Lost two on the play as Horn was able to stiff arm Brad West. And then Morrell made the tackle.
Well, we've talked about his feet, but right there, he shows you he's got arm strength as well. Quick feet, strong arms equals a good running back.
But he did lose yardage. Pretty loss of two, though. And it's second and 12.
A pretty loss of two.
Born over 100 yards rushing in the game. Trying to take it to the outside here. A flag down, and so is Horn. At midfield, he got slammed down out of bounds by Jason Hunter. Horn's okay, and again, a penalty marker in on the play.
Yeah, this has got to be a holding call. Yeah, it just looked to me like they hooked the end right there where Horn was trying to get outside.
Number 95, Omar Byram, looked like he was held up. I couldn't see who was behind him. Byram's number 95, and he's right here. Yeah, he's being held there. Barrett Anderson.
So they had a 2-yard loss on a running play. Take up more yardage here in the hole.
Holding on the offense, number 69, 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Replay second down.
And Appalachian State was trying to decide whether to accept the penalty or decline it. They did accept it, so it's second and 22. Otherwise, it would have been about third down and 7 or 8. Sanders to the air. Again flushed out by Morrell. And Sanders throws incomplete. Intended receiver was cut right. He would have been short by about 5 or 6 yards of the marker anyway. It'll bring up third down and 22.
Jerry Moore is an old style coach, and by accepting that penalty and forcing it second and long instead of third and 12, gets 10 yards of field position. And right now, with a 2-point game, an old style coach is thinking, let's win field possession every chance we get.
Moore has been here as a spectator the last handful of years, finally getting a chance to coach in the national title game. Third down and 22. Sanders in trouble, sacked back at the 25. Omar Byram and Joe Suter team up to take down Sanders.
Well, once again, it's the impact of the guys on the outside. Pay so much attention to Hunter and Morrell. You have a single blocker on Brown inside. And watch him beat his man. He just goes right around him and right into the backfield.
And right up the middle, they've got their third string center in there, Eric Hoffman, because Jeff Bates, the second string center, was declared ineligible just prior to this day.
Adam Koss got hit, penalty flag down. Northern Iowa's probably still gonna have to punt it though. They're gonna still have to punt the ball. It was a personal foul, though, so an automatic first down. Looked at first like it was running into, but they call roughing. That was pretty dangerous looking at the replay there. Woze, the guilty
foul,
man.
Roughing the kicker on the defense, number 18, 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
So instead of a fourth and 29 and you kick it away, you get a personal foul roughing the kicker.
And that does not go in the books as a turnover, but it's the same impact as a turnover because they were kicking that ball away. And again, that personal foul is called because of protecting the punter. Safety issue. and he's exposed, defenseless, and that happens, they're going to flag you for 15.
You know, I think I wasn't giving him the benefit of the doubt because last year he faked one pretty good, or last week he faked one pretty good, Koss did. As the handoff goes to Freeney, and he's up to midfield. But clearly looking at that replay, that definitely was roughing the kicker, not running into the kicker. But last week, he barely got touched. He went down. Great acting job, and that gave you and I a first down because they call a 15-yarder on Texas State.
And that led to a field goal in a game that ended tied, went to overtime. And we had a lot of fun talking about Koss acting there, but it was the official's mistake, not Koss's.
First time ever in the national championship game for both of these schools. Appalachian State minus 3 in turnover ratio. But they're only down by a couple of points as Freeney powers to the 44 for the first down. Zod Kelly made the tackle. Move the chains though for UNI.
That penalty gave new life to UNI, and Freeney is a bigger back than Horn and can pound inside.
Well, they played Iowa after that game. Their great court linebacker Chad Greenway said he expects Freeney to be in the NFL next year. Here's the penalty. Now Koss's leg will be in the air, and he gets hit right on the inside of that knee, which, Rod, like you said, is very dangerous.
Freeney again trying to push the pile, can't. Stacked up at the line of scrimmage. Well, Appalachian State, despite being minus 3 in the giveaway takeaway category, would have had a chance to drive down and take the lead had they not roughed the kicker, giving UNI an automatic first down.
Well, one thing Appalachian has done is taken UNI out of the deep ball passing game. Sanders hasn't had time to throw the ball deep because of the pressure he's getting from Hunter and Morrell.
They're 17th in the country in scoring defense, 17 points per game. UNI put up 37 last week, held to 16 so far in this game. A little delayed shovel pass to Horn, and he gets about 5 to the 38-yard line. Wiggins on the tackle.
Well, here's one thing to do to defensive ends that want to rush. Watch both of these guys come up like this, and what they'll do is just let them come in, suck them up, and then pitch it right between them. The difference here, Rod, is that this will not slow them down because their job isn't to stop the pitch. Their job is to get the quarterback under all circumstances.
Yeah, but you keep running those things to try and tire them out and slow down the pass rush somewhat.
Second and a handful. The ball goes under the legs of Sanders, who wisely falls on it at the 42-yard line. Smart play there by the sophomore Sanders. Eric Hoffman, who doesn't normally play center. He's a sophomore. He's starting for the senior, Jeff Bates, with a bad snap.
Now he tries to go to his right. That makes the ball slip out to the left because it is an experience. He doesn't get the ball snapped before he turns his hips. Now, Hoffman has really done a terrific job in this game given the circumstances, but that was a big mistake.
That was big because that was a third down and 5, and now you're back to fourth down and forever. And I'm sure Appalachian State has been told, don't even come near the punter, and Koss does not get off a good kick. So Appalachian State survives that near disaster after roughing the kicker on a fourth down and 29. It gives Northern Iowa an automatic first down. The Panthers cannot capitalize. 35 seconds left in the third quarter. Debate time. And
we welcome you back. A close game here for Appalachian State. The motivation always goes back to Coach Moore. He keeps in his locker very momentous tickets from games that he previously coached in but didn't advance. In 2000, they played Montana to come to this game, and they lost to Montana. He's always looked at those ticket stubs, guys, and now he's finally here.
Yeah, that was an overtime defeat, the closest they got to playing in Chattanooga. He's been here as a spectator for many years, finally getting a chance to coach in a national title game and hoping to win one. And if he does, it might be because of senior quarterback Richie Williams. So that pass is knocked away and complete. Williams coming back from an ankle injury, only played one play in the second quarter. That was a Hail Mary at the end. But the last time he was on the field, earlier this quarter, he led Appalachian State on a touchdown drive to pull the Mountaineers within two. Appalachian State has been in UNI territory 8 times already in this game, but only 16 points. Williams with a swing pass to Little. Nowhere to go. Tanner Varner on the play. Loss of about four. It'll be third and long.
Right now the question, will they blitz or will they just bring four and allow Williams time to throw?
I don't think they'll blitz. I don't think it's in their personality to do so in this area of the field. I think it's what they should be doing with the quarterback who can't move, but they've shown that they won't do it until they get backed up to their end zone.
We are going to the fourth quarter on Championship Friday. In 1AA, one of these schools will win its first ever national title. 16-14 as we go to the fourth quarter in the 1AA national championship game in Chattanooga. In the battle of the bestsellers, Charles Frazier, who wrote Cold Mountain, attended Appalachian State. Robert James Waller, who authored The Bridges of Madison County, went to Northern Iowa.
Who had the better book sales?
I don't know.
That's the real competition.
I think Bridges had the higher movie gate.
You've probably seen that about 30 times.
Not a single time. I was watching Rambo.
Third down and 13, Williams. Pumps once, then fires incomplete. Brandon Turner wants an interference call, won't get it. Michael Mathis and John Herman put pressure and hit Williams pretty hard.
You and I finally thinking about getting after Williams a bit. He gets rolled up that time by John Herman.
That should have been a penalty. That was well after the throw. How was that not roughing the passer? Matt Dodge to boot it away to Dre Dokes. Can I get a second on that one, please? You guys disagree?
Apparently not.
Dokes back at the 20-yard line. And slammed down at the 27 by Billy Riddle.
Knowing that the quarterback is injured, you want the officials to call it a little bit tighter and give the quarterback the benefit of the doubt, but they can't do that. They have to call it straight down the middle.
Yeah, you can't penalize the defense because the quarterback is gimpy and can't protect himself.
It has nothing to do with that. It was well after the throw. You can't hit a quarterback.
He rolled up on him. He wasn't really going after him. Hey, you want to put a skirt on these guys now? He's a quarterback.
Well, he's
out there. He's
got
to play.
He's
not flag football.
Brace. I mean,
give me Bridges of Madison County, would you?
Maybe you could put some lace around his ankle brace. Would that satisfy him?
Come on.
He's showing a lot of courage out there. This is not about him. It's about the officials. And I think they made the right call.
Shotgun from the 25. Sanders looking for the deep ball. The out and up, and it is nearly picked off by Justin Woze. He can't believe he didn't pull it in. Marcus Morrell put pressure on Sanders that time. Wednesday night bowl season continues on ESPN. Toledo and UTEP in the GMAC Bowl Wednesday, 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. It's also available in sparkling high definition on ESPN HD. Two good quarterbacks, Jordan Palmer and Bruce Gradkowski, going head-to-head. Some terrific non-BCS bowl games. The BCS games are great. There's some really good non-BCS bowl games this year. Freeney to the 30-yard line. Got about five of the play. Going to bring up a critical third down and a handful. Cam Spear made the tackle for Appalachian State. What a great time of year, huh? You got the 1AA playoffs wrapping up, bowl season starting.
We get that next week. We get going with that.
The New Orleans Bowl, GMAC Bowl. Third down and five. Sanders again being chased by Jason Hunter. Makes a miss once. Look at the speed by Hunter. And how about the pass by Sanders to Cutright for the Northern Iowa first down. Who made the better play there?
Wow.
Sanders, the little things that he does, the little knacks that he has, he gives Hunter just a little stiff arm here. Watch him push off on number 97 to get the separation right there. Just enough so Hunter can't get his arm on him, and that's why he has the separation.
You kidding me? This is a quarterback that they didn't really recruit. They recruited as a walk-on. They gave a scholarship to someone else, and he's beating everybody out.
They've been chasing him all night long, and he makes plays. Here is Freeney through a gap into Appalachian State territory. Woze pushed him out of the 47-yard line. Northern Iowa leading Appalachian State in the first ever meeting between these two schools, and the first time since 1987 we've had two first-time finalists. David Horn with better than 100 yards rushing. His backup Terrence Freeney getting into the act on this drive. 17-yard run in the previous play. Puts the ball at the 47 of Appalachian State. Freeney again. Nowhere for him to run, except into number 44, Marcus Morrell. Cam Spear also on the stop. Take a look at our Coca-Cola ESPN 2 game track.
Points off turnovers have been big for you and I. It started in the first quarter with a fumble, and then Williams getting back in the ball game in the third quarter, missing the first half due to that ankle injury, limped around and made some plays.
Now, this tremendous courage is inspiring his teammates.
Sanders out of the shotgun on second and 11. Great fake, and Sanders slides down to the 40. Hunter made the tackle, gain of 8 on the play. Third and short coming up. Hunter and Morrell have combined for 13 tackles, a couple of tackles for a loss, and Hunter also has a sack.
And there you see Freeney coming out. He was in there, I believe, to add a little bit more physical presence and pound the ball inside. And now they come back with a guy who's a little quicker.
That's a lot of carries, though, for Horn, 22 in the game. Third down and 3. Sanders again keeps. And guess who? Jason Hunter showing tremendous speed again. Wow. How quick is this 6'4", 235-pound senior?
And he gets sucked in by the fake, and then he comes back out, and that's the recovery speed. He doesn't take a false step, he plants and goes.
He's got those long arms, and that's one of the reasons people believe he can play at the next level in a 3-4 defense. One of those outside linebackers.
Wiggins back to receive the Adam Cost punt. And this one will sail into the end zone. So Appalachian State down 2. Early fourth quarter will take over at the 20-yard line when we come back. Also, our Friday night debate when we return. To playoff or not to playoff? Early fourth quarter in the 1AA National Championship game in Chattanooga, Tennessee. Northern Iowa leads Appalachian State by 2. The winner of this game will capture its first ever National Football Championship. Appalachian State, in fact, has never even won a team sport championship in school history. First down from the 20-yard line. Richie Williams finds an open man out to the 31-yard line. Zach Johnson with the first down. It's time now for our Friday night debate, and tonight's question, as you would expect, with a 1AA playoff game and bowl games to start next week, guys, to playoff or not to playoff? That's the question.
Go ahead, Travis.
I think not. I think a plus one, yes, but you've got to look at what you lose, not just what you gain. If you have a playoff, like a 1AA playoff in 1A, you've got one champion at the end of it. With bowls, you've got 28 bowl champions. I think that's better for 1A football.
We'll get Rod's take after this play. First down from the 32. Williams to the air again. And the ball is tipped and incomplete. We've seen a lot of batted balls at the line of scrimmage tonight by Northern Iowa defensive lineman. That was Stenzer who got a hand on it. Okay, Rod, your turn.
I think you thought I was going to go in favor of one. Huh? I don't think we really know enough about whether to have one or not to make a decision. I think the discussion hasn't been thoughtful enough. We know the benefit. The benefit is you get to crown a champion and you get to make a lot of money. What's the downside? I mean, coaches have been telling us during this playoff season for 1AA, there's a physical toll, there's an academic toll, but we don't really know the extent of that. And if you bring in $100 million for a playoff, how much of that or any part of it should go to players or player services?
exploitation of players becomes an issue for presidents.
Second down, Williams in trouble. Gets away from one man, gets leveled as he gets rid of it, incomplete. Charles Johnson putting pressure on Williams. Let's take a look at what America thinks. At ESPN.com, keyword Friday night debate, and 85% say yes, go to a playoff in a 1A.
That is not a surprise.
Yeah.
You know, but there are presidents and there are coaches who don't feel that way because of some of the concerns, and I don't think they know enough about those concerns yet to make that determination.
It's easy to look at the end result and say, okay, the BCS works once out of every 3 years, and then 1AA works every year because you know who the champion is for certain in 1AA with a playoff system. Williams doubling off on third down and long, and they're gonna get the first down. Richardson, the leading receiver, picks up about 16 on third down and 10. There is a penalty flag on the play. And they have picked up the penalty flag. So it is a first down for Appalachian State at its 47-yard line. Mike from New York says that 1A does not need a playoff because every game truly counts. He says a playoff would ruin 1A football. I don't know about that. Through the hands of Little, incomplete on first and 10. Let's go back to the mailbag. Garrett from Fort Worth says, yes, there should be a college football playoff. I think you quote should take the eight BCS teams and put them in an Elite Eight playoff. If 1AA can do it, so can we.
But they already have in position the games for a four-team playoff because starting next year they have an extra BCS game played after the first four. But instead of having that be a true championship game from the four, what they're doing is adding an extra game for two extra teams so that they don't get sued. They've got the ability.
And talking to the coaches here this week, kind of mixed reviews. Some like it, some don't because of the physical toll and the wear and tear of the coaches as well. Speaking of wear and tear, how about Varner with a huge hit on Richardson at midfield? Richardson still made the catch and actually picked up 3 yards, but he paid for it.
And Varner has made a couple of plays tonight. None more dramatic than that one. Watch this hit.
And they did rule it incomplete. He did not hang on to the ball, so it is incomplete.
What a great read by Varner. He saw the play break down. He saw the quarterback looking for his outlet, Richardson in the flat, and he just teed it up.
Now this is where you and I should be bringing some pressure.
Third down and 10. Pump fake for Williams. Steps up and throws incomplete. Trying for Dexter Jackson. And it's fourth and 10.
And they did bring pressure. And Williams can't move around effectively in the pocket to find throwing lanes. If you don't sack him, forcing him to move is just as effective because he can't move well right now.
I think he was mad that Dexter Jackson stopped. Jackson was going and he looked and he saw Turner coming at him and he also saw a defender in the way and he slowed down. I think that's what he's mad about. Dokes backs up to the 11, met immediately. Titus Howard with a special team stop. Richie Williams. And some of the coaches upset with Patrick Turner, or Brandon Turner rather, and Dexter Jackson. Miscommunication on receiving routes.
NCAA Championships on ESPN. The Division I-AA Football National Championship game is brought to you by Stouffer's. See what's cooking at Stouffer's.
Well, some miscommunication on the receiving routes between Dexter Jackson and Brandon Turner, and Turner not happy after the coaches and quarterback Richie Williams made some remarks to him after he came off the field.
Well, he had everybody yelling at him. I mean, this is a predictable response to when you get treated like that, and they can't afford to lose a player emotionally or mentally right now. They got to get him back involved with the team.
He's a senior, and he can't be having other players pointing their finger at him like that. That's mishandling a guy on the sideline.
Looked like he ran the wrong route, but Dexter Jackson also stopped on the play as the pass was thrown in between them. Here's a pass that's complete to Cerency for a first down of the 23. 13 yards on the play. Eric Sanders again making a big play. That was first down from his own 10, and he threw that pass from his end zone.
Well, he's been incredibly calm and poised. Probably has not been pressured in any game as much as he has been tonight by those two terrific defensive ends, Hunter and Morrell.
If UNI wins this game, is he the MVP?
Probably. Probably.
Had over 400 yards last week and four touchdowns in UNI's first ever win in the semifinals. Sanders on the keeper. Got maybe a yard of the 25. Cam Spear on the tackle. Well, Stacy talked earlier about Richie Williams being a terrific leader, and he is right now discussing things with Brandon Turner, trying to calm him down.
Well, that's the right thing to do. Even if Turner was at fault and ran the wrong route, you don't need to get him stirred up and upset. All you need to do is correct it and move on. And the fact that he got so upset means that they didn't understand the kind of personality that he has, and they set him off.
Second down and 9. Sanders to throw. And the ball's out! And it's picked up by Hunter! Jason Hunter, touchdown, Appalachian State! Shift in momentum here in Chattanooga in the national title game.
And Jason Hunter has been the most dominant player on the field tonight. That ball just slips out, and he's in the right spot with his great speed to get the touchdown.
That is Hunter's third touchdown of the season. We do have instant replay, but it doesn't matter now. And the extra point is good. Jason Hunter and Marcus Morrell have both been spectacular. Hunter, great play just to scoop it up. And then he storms into the end zone to give the Mountaineers a 5-point lead. First team All-American Marcus Morrell forces a fumble on quarterback Eric Sanders. Jason Hunter picks it up and runs into the end zone, changing momentum in this game as Appalachian State takes the lead for the first time since it was 7-6 in the first half.
You talk about MVP, you might have to think about Hunter. That guy has been dominant.
He's got a sack, a tackle for a loss, and now a touchdown in the game. Also, 8 tackles. Pretty good for a defensive end. Along the sideline is Goodwin. And wrapped up, spins out of a couple tackles, and gets a block. Great return by Goodwin to the 33-yard line.
Let's go back to the big play. Keep your eye on the outside there. Watch Morrell come around. Watch his right hand on the ball right there. And then his good buddy of 10 years on the other side, Jason Hunter, scoops it up for 6.
He tries to step up, but doesn't get up far enough. Sanders' eyes are downfield. But remember what happened last week. You have to know where Hunter is. In the last drive, he strips Engel Martin of Furman, picked up by Byron, who takes it down to the 1-yard line and seals the victory. Same man. Same play.
Sanders has room to throw, and the pass just out of the outstretched arms of Brian Cutright incomplete. Well, the difference last week was that they could not review that play, and the Furman coaches felt that if it had been reviewed, it would have been overturned, that the quarterback's arm was going forward. Although Dave Barnett and Bill Curry both said as they watched the replay that it was the correct call. This one here clearly was out, and they could have had further review on the play if they wanted to, but decided not to, that the ball was clearly knocked away before Sanders' arm was moving forward. SportsCenter coming up next on ESPN2. Still a lot of time left in this one. Under 9 to go. Sanders, a little shovel pass as he pitches it to Patrick Hunter, who's been quiet, had 2 touchdowns last week. Been held only a few catches tonight. Got about 7 on that play of the 40.
Keep in mind that last week in the semifinal against Texas State, that man led his team to a game-tying touchdown and 2-point conversion in the last minute of the game.
And Rod, he looked like he looks here. Calm, as if he were at practice.
But he's not. He's in the national championship game in front of a sellout crowd, the largest capacity at a 1AA national final since 1996. Sanders finds Sorensen, who's able to pull it in and get the first down to the 43-yard line. Jerome Touchstone on the tackle.
And Touchstone almost got there in time on that play.
Look at Sanders. I mean, if you were, didn't know, and you were just to guess, if he was in a big game or if he was just in a scrimmage, what would you think? Look at his body language. He's completely still. He's calm. He's, and the team around him is feeding off of them. They are calm, too.
He's 17-2 since taking over midway through last season as the starting quarterback. Takes the low snap here. Gonna get hit, and he loses the ball again. This time, Northern Iowa recovers. It was Marcus Morrell again who forced another fumble. That's his 7th on the year and 2nd tonight. And Joe Lobdo recovered it for Northern Iowa on the play.
In the first quarter, we talked about the inability of UNI to handle these ends. Fourth quarter now, it hasn't changed. They have to get another guy out to help him, Trevor.
And UNI coaches told us that they were most fearful of these two ends, Marcus Morrell, Jason Hunter. Last week, Furman head coach Bobby Lamb told Bill Curry he was most afraid of them. And they had the big plays in that game, too.
On 2nd and 22, Sanders pressured again.
They can't block him.
Jason Hunter.
I have never seen a performance by an end like this. You have to go back to watching guys like Lawrence Taylor dominate coming off the edge.
Well, the guy he beats is first team All-Gateway Conference number 77, Chad Reinhart, an outstanding offensive tackle, and he goes inside as if Reinhart weren't even there.
Well, they were trying to set up the little shovel screen, and you see Horn just tries to chip him, but a chip isn't good enough there. He didn't get much of it.
How about the Richard Dent comparison?
Yeah, exactly. That's a good one.
Third down and 34. Pitch to Horn. Horn makes one man miss, but couldn't get the second guy, and he comes up about 8 yards shy of the first down. Jeremy Wiggins on the tackle.
Well, that was the play they were trying to run on second down, and they didn't get it done. They come right back with it, and this time they let him go outside and then have Horn just come out on the shovel's toss.
Well, a punt is an awful lot better than a sack, a fumble, return for a touchdown, which is what happened just a minute ago.
Adam Koss running it away. Jackson waiting from the 22-yard line. Up to the 25. 5 minutes, 26 seconds remaining in the season for Appalachian State and Northern Iowa, who will roll to their first ever national championship. Appalachian State with the football, leading 21-16, 5 minutes and 26 seconds remaining in this championship game, with SportsCenter coming up next on ESPN2. John Wiley, the defensive coordinator for Appalachian State, is wearing that little mesh thing for one of two reasons. Either he thinks it's really snazzy, or to differentiate himself from the other coaches so that they can see who's making the signals on defense.
You've got a couple of those in your wardrobe.
I had one on before. Little swing pass from Williams to Richardson. makes two men miss. And Richardson is able to get very close to the marker at the 35-yard line. Well, we mentioned Eric Sanders is a possible MVP candidate. How about for Appalachian State? Or is it co-MVPs for Morrell and Hunter if Appalachian State wins this game?
Well, they've been better than advertised. They've been dominant tonight. Even in the first half when the offense wasn't moving, they kept the game close with big plays that forced field goals.
Richardson did not get it, so it's second and one. And he appears to have it here. Out to the 37-yard line.
Think about that, though. With Richie Williams leading them down to a touchdown earlier in the half, coming back, standing in the pocket, immobile like a statue, taking hits, getting up slowly, limping down the field, and he's not the first person that comes to mind for MVP. It's those defensive ends. What a performance by all three of them.
Williams did not start. As you look at the poor rushing effort, but that's in part because Williams is hampered because of that ankle injury. He is a guy that's rushed for nearly 1,000 yards this year, but is one-dimensional. And he gets to the 40-yard line there, picking up 2 yards. He got hurt on a similar play last week against Furman, as Northern Iowa is going to call its first timeout. We'll have two remaining.
But he's the second leading rusher on this team coming into the ballgame. And this offense is based on the quarterback doing this, moving the football, and that's not happening.
More on Richie Williams. Here's Stacey Dale Schumann.
Dave, when Williams came into this game, the aura changed, the whole mentality changed. They got their swagger back. I asked Trey Elder, the backup quarterback, yesterday, what is it like leading this football team as a starter in this game, as he did start this game? And he said, this isn't my team. This is Richie's team. I'm just trying to help him out right now. Guys, they worship this player, and they're playing for him right now.
Well, we asked Jerry Moore yesterday, Stacey, whether Williams would start, and he said, I'm going to suit him up, see how he does in warm-ups, probably won't start him, but might play him, although Williams told him, when we asked him, hey, does Williams want to play? He said, Williams wants what's best for the team.
Well, Williams didn't even know that he wanted him to play quarterback when he first came as a recruit. He was recruited as an athlete. It took him about a minute and a half to figure out that this guy was a quarterback, but then he's a running and passing quarterback. In this second half, running taken away, he has proven that he can move the ball exclusively with his arm.
I fault you and I for part of that. They have not been aggressive, and they haven't gone after him. They allowed him to do one thing and sit back there and throw instead of putting pressure on him and force him to be the complete player that he normally is.
And his numbers aren't great, but they've been good enough. Appalachian State leads because of a defensive touchdown by Jason Hunter. Williams hit, and the ball's out, and it's an incomplete pass. His arm was going forward. Tanner Varner hit the quarterback. Charles Johnson recovered it, but it's going to be ruled incomplete that his arm was going forward. It'll make it a 3rd down and 7.
Every time we've seen a little pressure, and you see they bring a safety this time, Varner, number 20, that's what they should have been doing the entire second half.
That was pretty close. Looked like the arm was going forward, though.
Any movement forward is all you need. That is moving forward. Any doubt, tie goes to the quarterback.
Williams going deep. Man there, but it's just overthrown and complete. Trying for Dexter Jackson. And it will be 4th down, and Appalachian State will have to kick it away. Northern Iowa will have close to 4 minutes to work with in 2 timeouts, and they trail by 5. That was close. Jackson had his man beat, but the pass just overthrown, and now Matt Dodge had to punt it away. Dre Dokes back to return at his 21-yard line. We've got a whistle and a penalty flag. And keep in mind here, guys, that Northern Iowa has won all of its playoff games by 3 points each was down in the fourth quarter to Eastern Washington 31-14 and was down by 8 late in the fourth quarter last week against Texas State and obviously won both those games.
Oh, the pattern has been the same for them the last few weeks. Get ahead early.
False start on the offense, number 21, 5-yard penalty, still fourth down. Timer, please reset the clock to 3:49. 3:49, thank you.
Get ahead early in the ball game, fall behind or get tied in the fourth quarter, and then find a way to win it late in the game.
The Appalachian State coaches tell their players every week to find the breaking point of their opponent. But this week they said Northern Iowa doesn't have a breaking point. You can push and they won't break.
They led New Hampshire 21-0. New Hampshire stormed back to tie the game, but Northern Iowa won by 3. Bouncing ball pulled in by Dokes. And the ball is loose. Dokes fumbled it, but Northern Iowa recovered it. Fortuitous bounce. It was punched out by Cam Spear. But Northern Iowa able to recover into the hands of James Lindgren. So they survive a scare and will get a chance to go down and win the game.
Back in Chattanooga, if you've missed anything, you've missed defense. It's been the Twins for Appalachian State, 97-44. Hunter and Morrell.
And the defense has been playing exceptionally well all game. 3 turnovers by Appalachian State in the first half, and yet only 1 touchdown allowed off of those turnovers by this defense.
But Northern Iowa has been here before. The defense has been terrific in the fourth quarter for Appalachian State. But even though Eric Sanders is a sophomore, he's played like a senior in the postseason. Has time to throw there and finds a wide open Surrency at the 30-yard line for a 13-yard pickup and a first down.
Well, that time they slid Horn to Morrell's side, so they had 2 guys out there on Morrell. And he had plenty of time to look and throw to that side to find Surrency.
And they had Brian Cutright on the opposite side, so they ended up with maximum protection. It's about darn time, don't you think?
Yeah. How many sacks do you have to take before you figure it out, huh?
Shotgun here on first down at the 31-yard line. Sanders again to throw. And what a grab, and then the ball is dropped by Cutright, incomplete. He looked like he had it, and then Cam Spear at the last second punched it out. Jeremy Wiggins was also in the area. That would have been huge, but Cutright just couldn't pull it in.
He was bobbling it the whole time.
Wiggins and Lynch, a pair of safeties who relish big hits. They call themselves Black Thunder and White Lightning. They say they are the 2 best safeties in Division I AA, and they gave themselves those nicknames.
Wiggins put a hit on LSU's early D set as hard as any hit he must have gotten all year from the SEC.
Sanders dumps it off to Horn. Greeted by Brad West at the line of scrimmage. No gain. 3rd down and 10. Now if Northern Iowa doesn't get it here, with 2 timeouts remaining, 3:17 to go, do you punt it away or do you go for it? And does it depend on what you do here?
I think it depends on what you do here. If you're staring a 4th and 10, I think you have to kick it away. If you get anywhere close, I think you have a shot to go after it.
Mark Farley hoping to take home his first national championship. Appalachian State hoping for its first team sport national title in the history of its program as that pass is overthrown and nearly intercepted by Corey Lynch. Brian Cutright appeared to be open. Sanders couldn't hit him, and it's 4th down and 11.
Appearances can be deceiving. They were playing too deep, and that was a tough way to try to drop that ball in over the linebackers and in front of the safeties.
And they're going to punt it away here on 4th and 11. 3:13 to go. They have 2 timeouts left.
Yeah, right call. Don't you think?
Yep.
Yeah, it is the right call.
Cross to punt it. Dexter Jackson back at his 35. Appalachian State roughed Cross earlier in the game on a 4th and 29, and Northern Iowa got an automatic first down. They're not even going to come after him this time. It's a great punt, and Jackson lets it go. And it will be down right around the 16-yard line. Coming up, Sports Center with Neil Everett and Scott Van Pelt. All the day's news and highlights, including Shaq versus Allen Iverson. Showdown in the Meadowlands and the Bucks facing the ultimate challenge. That's coming up next on Sports Center. Tampa Bay taking on the New England Patriots. Don't sleep on the Pats now, guys, as you look at what the Bengals are doing and the Steelers and obviously the Colts. Don't forget about New England.
Bill Belichick has had Peyton Manning's and the Colts offense number in recent years. They disrupt the timing of the passing attack. This year, can they do it with the Colts improved?
52-yard punt, and Appalachian State will take over at its 18-yard line. And a pass play out to the 26-yard line as it's pulled in by Johnson. You guys like the decision to throw the ball here with the lead?
I do. I think they need to be aggressive because they have no running game. When the quarterback goes out of the running game, they don't have a running game.
And Rod, they're at the line right now and they're no huddle. They aren't huddling, but it's not a hurry up no huddle. They wait until that play clock gets down as low as possible.
This is what they call Indy. They have three different ways that they run their no huddle. Jet, where they run up to the line quickly and snap it. Indy right here, where they run up to the line, then call the play. And also normal is there they run it and they come up short apparently. Richardson tackled by Heideman at the 28. That's going to bring up a third down and one. And Northern Iowa will call a timeout and we'll have one left.
Northern Iowa will be expecting a run here. Rod, do you think they should throw it?
No, I think that they will go ahead and run it here and give themselves a chance to burn off some more clock if they don't pick it up and or force you and I to use their last timeout. What would you do?
I think that's a great call right there because time is very important. Appalachian State's defense has played very well, and without a timeout, it limits UNI's ability to go to the middle of the field on this final drive.
Man, I'm really worried about you guys. There's something in the water up here in Chattanooga. You guys are like twice now.
Well, this is this one's not controversial. I mean, it's pretty obvious here. Your defense is playing lights out. I mean, why take a risk if you don't have to?
Well, right there they tried to run it and barely got a yard.
You know, I think at this point you'd be in pretty good shape if you run some clock off and you kick it away and you tell your defense to win the game.
You know, I'd run over his right tackle, Matt Eisenhower. He won the Jacobs Trophy as the top offensive lineman in the Southern Conference, number 62.
You know, the interesting thing here is that they hardly ever line up behind center to run a quarterback sneak or anything like that. And with Williams being as gimpy as he is, you really can't take a chance on running the quarterback sneak to try to get the first down because he can't push off on that foot very well.
Appalachian State leading by 5, 2:15 to play in the fourth quarter. As you really see Williams hobbling. This game really taking a toll on that injured ankle. Go to NCAASports.com for a preview of the Division III Football National Championship. It's tomorrow at 1 o'clock Eastern, by the way, on ESPN2. And they go out of shotgun here on third down at about a half a yard. Richardson appears to have it to the 29-yard line. Tanner Varner made the tackle. It looks like Richardson got enough to move the sticks. And Jerry Moore starting to smell that first national championship. Oh, how many times he has sat in the stands as a spectator, never even getting a chance to compete in the national final. But after last week's win over rival Furman, this could be Moore's greatest moment as a coach. And he's been a coach a long time, an assistant at Nebraska, an assistant for Hayden Fry at SMU back in the 60s. And in his 17th year as the head coach at Appalachian State, the all-time winningest coach in the Southern Conference. Richardson to the 32, 3 yards of the play. Northern Iowa still with one timeout remaining.
You see, he spent a few years at Nebraska and, in fact, brought the Nebraska offense over to Appalachian State. And then they moved away from that just a couple of years ago after visiting West Virginia and getting Rich Rodriguez to sell them on going no huddle and the read option game.
12 straight winning seasons, and they have had 16 winning seasons in more than 17 years. but never even a finalist. But thanks to Jason Hunter right there, number 97, and his fumble recovery for a touchdown, Moore may get that elusive national championship.
And remember that Moore practices team 3 days a week in full pads to keep the routine. Another thing that he did was not talk about the national championship, because during the regular season, they don't talk about the national championship. They talk only about the next opponent, Northern Iowa. But right now, there's no way they can think anything other than the championship if they can run this thing out.
Well, Moore's defense has been spectacular. You and I averages 31 points per game, but no points in the second half. And only 13 points off three turnovers, and one of those was at right around the 20-yard line at the beginning of the game. They had to settle for a field goal. If Mark Farley's team loses this game, he'll look back at missed opportunities on turnovers, especially early in the game.
That's exactly right. They had chances to put up a couple of touchdowns with a short field and didn't get it done.
Williams on second and six, and it's broken up, so that will stop the clock. How about that decision with no timeouts remaining?
Now, that one I don't get. The first one to open up the drive made sense. That one didn't make any sense to me. I mean, you stop the clock for those guys.
And Northern Iowa can't stop it. They don't have any timeouts left.
Exactly.
That was nearly a pick back the other way.
Well, now you got to throw it again, right? On third down and six, you got to try to get the first down if you tried it on second down.
But their running game has not been good. And at this point, you might be better off simply running the football to force more time off the clock and a timeout.
Appalachian State wants to talk it over.
I don't think they can afford to throw the ball here.
If you ran it there, you're down to a minute. Then you run another play, you're down to about 30 seconds, and you kick it away.
Exactly.
Now there's a minute 40 left. If you run it, okay, it's down to a minute, but if you throw it and it's incomplete, well, then Northern Iowa will get the ball with about 85 seconds or so left.
I'm still stunned by that near pick six. I mean, you guys are doing all the math, and that's great, but I'm sitting here thinking, my goodness, that was almost taken back for a potential game-winning touchdown. Right now, if they do throw this ball, they should throw it right down the middle, not take a shot at the corner.
Well, we had a controversial decision at the end of our game last week between Northern Iowa and Texas State in the semifinals. It was 37-29 late in the game. David Horn scored a touchdown, then a two-point conversion, a miraculous one at that, as you see the catch by Surrency to tie the game. A minute 27 left, three timeouts for Texas State, none for Northern Iowa. Texas State elects to play for overtime. Northern Iowa gets a field goal on its possession. Texas State turns it over on its possession, and Northern Iowa advances to the title game.
Clock management cannot be a knee-jerk reaction. It has to be thought through and discussed during the week. You have to be prepared to know what you're going to do in a given situation.
And they are going to run on third and six, and Richardson is going to get the first down. And that should do it. They should be able to take a knee three times and secure a national championship.
This is a gutsy run. He finds the seam. He knows where the first down marker is. And you and I could not do anything to stop him.
Rod, you talked about their inability to run the ball. That 10-yard gain there was their longest running play of the entire game. Richie Williams takes a knee. Two more. And this will be over. The game-changing play, Jason Hunter, a fumble recovery for a touchdown on a forced fumble by Morrell.
Hard to believe that that young man, Jason Hunter, only played 1 year of high school football and only 3 years here. He missed a season. He's a very young football player. See fans across the way jump in the wall.
And that should do it. The Appalachian State fans about to rush the field, and the Mountaineers reach the mountaintop for the first time in history. They are national champions. in 1AA football in 2005. Short by 5 points to Appalachian State. It's the first ever national championship of any kind in team sports in Appalachian State history, dating back to 1903. With a key forced fumble recovered by Jason Hunter and returned for a touchdown in the second half, the key play of the game.
Make no mistake about it, the defense did the job for Appalachian State. Jason Hunter, 97, Marcus Morrell, 44. Big time performances tonight.
And after 16 years, number 17 is the charm for Jerry Moore, the head coach at Appalachian State, who's standing by with Stacy.
Coach Moore, 17 years at this program. What are your emotions right now with this championship?
Oh, just unbelievable. For every football player that's ever played here and every student that ever's gone to Appalachian, what a great thing. It's a great night for us.
What kind of inspiration was Richie Williams coming back into this game with the injury?
Well, as I told you at the half, he had done this against Wofford when he was a sophomore, and we knew we were having trouble running the ball. And really, Trey didn't bring anything to it because we weren't getting the option. If we could run the option, then we'd have left Trey in the ball game. But we knew we were going to throw it, and you saw what he's made out of.
Coach, it's time for you to take your trophy home. It's right beside you on the right. Congratulations.
Well, there are two others who are watching this game right now. We're all smiles. Moore's friends and mentors, Tom Osborne and Hayden Frye, as Jerry Moore gives Appalachian State its first ever national championship. 21-16 the final score over Northern Iowa. This game has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com. For Rod Gilmore, Trevor Maddox, Stacy Dale Schumann, special thanks to producer Kim Belt. I'm Dave Pack. So long from Chattanooga. Sports Center is next.